In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Our Lady, seat of wisdom. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay, today's lecture, we are going to commence reading the Bible. As St. Thomas says, an error in the beginning is an error indeed, because if you mess up the beginning, everything else subsequently that is built upon it will be wrong. You will miss the mark if you start off. And so this first chapter, I'm going to go into some depth, and we're going to look at it. I'm going to give you actually primarily a historical critical interpretation of a lot of these things, because those are things that you won't have access to when you read commentaries at a future date, especially like patristic commentaries and things like that. So I'm going to do literary criticism too. We're going to look at some of the artistry, some things that we now know, and the form of this first chapter. And that's because of what we've already read in our reader, which was Leo XIII and Pius XII. And frankly, Augustine, in his own way, all said, like, knowing the contemporary culture is actually imperative in order to understand the signs, to understand the language. Now, Augustine said, like, his first principle after his twofold principle of love, which is just, that's what is foundational to all of Scripture. He said his first principle is to memorize the Bible. Okay. Because his way of looking at it, the best way of uncovering how a word is meant is to see how the Scripture itself uses it. So I've given you a couple images here. Okay, what is this image? Well, this image is these little lines here down at the bottom of this. Is every chapter in the Bible. Okay? This is every chapter in the Bible, from the Old Testament to the New Testament. That's what these lines down here are. Between every chapter that is referenced, there's an arc, okay? The closer the chapters, the colder the color. The higher up, the warmer the color gets. So basically, this is a visual representation that they've made with the computer of all of the cross-references so far uncovered in Scripture. Now, that is a pretty complicated document. Meaning, you know, Genesis chapter 1, like, is referenced all the way back there in the New Testament. On top of that, it's going to be referenced throughout all the other Scripture. So, it's harder to know, actually, like, what does this saying mean? You know, verse 1 of Genesis. Well, how has every subsequent generation for the two millennia that the Bible was handed on used it, interpreted it, and handed on to you to understand? Well, that's a much more complicated task. This is why we actually approach it quite humbly. Like, do I really know it? No, Augustine said memorize it. No, there's no way he, even as brilliant as he is, there's no way he could have always had in mind like every single reverberation of a text through itself. Because the Bible is a pretty big book. But this just shows you, I guess, graphically how complicated it can be. Here's another one if we just zoom in a little bit. Now, this is just the book of Genesis, all of its chapters, okay, and how they're cross-referenced to all subsequent books in the Old Testament. Now, there's a lot of lines there, which means just the one book of Genesis is referenced all the way, like, I mean, first book all the way down to the prophets. You can see it's being referenced down to the prophets, down to Daniel, is where this arch is going down here. Lots of references to Genesis. And hey, it's not just an Old Testament book. Let's look at the New Testament. This is the cross-references of the first book of the Bible in the New Testament. Look in the Pauline epistles. Paul loves Genesis. He uses it all the time. Look how many times Romans, you can just tell graphically by how dark the line is. Luke and Matthew seem to have the most as far as the evangelists go. But the book of Genesis is a book that is used everywhere in the entirety of the Bible. On top of that, if I just wanted to go back again, just look up next to that one is going to be the chapter we're looking at. Look how dark it is right there. going down. I mean, an error in the beginning is an error indeed. And how is one used and understood in the Bible is a much more difficult question than people think. So if you open up chapter 1 and you read and you go like, oh, he's telling me how the world was made. And it was made in 6 days and God made everything. If that's your understanding of it, that's pretty surface, pretty shallow. If you start thinking he's giving you scientific cosmology, he's trying to explain to you physics, you're probably going to miss out on it. That's true meaning, because that's not actually why it's referenced so much. It's referenced so much for a much deeper significance. Okay, so this is how our text commences. Okay, I want you to suspend for a second, actually in your Bible, what we call chapters and verses. Okay, chapters and verses are not original to the text itself. Those are subsequently put on. Basically, every verse in the Bible, every sentence in the Bible has a numeric value to it, has a verse. If you don't know what this means, let's see. Does this work? No, go back. We're not doing that yet. Oh, man. Okay, just so you can understand. When you see a reference like this, the first number is a chapter, the colon separates then from the verses. So that's chapter 1, verse 1, 2. Okay, that's a typical way of citing something in Scripture. Every sentence has a numeric value. Every group of paragraphs has a numeric value. The entire Bible is like that. So Genesis has a series of chapters. Every chapter has a series of verses. Those are put on just so we can help navigate and do references. But they're not original to the text. Okay, so those are works of editors. For that reason, those of you who have an RSV, if you turn your page, you'll see chapter 2 starts with the line, the Douay Rheims does this too, but starts with, thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And it goes down for another 3 verses, and then there's the editor of this Bible puts a break, and then there's a new paragraph at verse 4. For all intents and purposes, what you want to understand is that the beginning of the Bible is actually, at least the first section of it, according to how it's written, is going to be from chapter 1, verse 1, to chapter 2, verse 3, okay? So the seventh day is part of the prologue to the book of Genesis. So when you think of the beginning of Genesis, you want to think of the first 7 days of God's creation. The seven is a unit. It's manifestly a unit. So don't let that chapter 2 cause an artificial break in the narrative, okay? We're going to find that the book of Genesis is divided into a series of sections, and they're very easy to identify. The first section is a prologue, an introduction to the rest of Genesis is going to be the 7 days creation. Okay? Actually, it's 6 days creation and a seventh day of rest. But that's a complete unit. Okay, this unit itself has a prologue to it. 2 verses. In the beginning, God created heaven and earth. It's actually plural. Created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was void and empty, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved over the waters. I'm just going to go through and read this whole first thing first, and then we're going to get into some of the different things going on in it. Then it starts with this first day. And God said, be light made. And light was made. And God saw the light, that it was good. And he divided the light from the darkness. And he called the light day, and the darkness night. And there was evening and morning, one day. And God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters. And let it separate the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament and separate the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so. God called the firmament heaven, and there was evening, and there was morning, a second day. And God said, let the waters under the heavens be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were under gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, let the earth put forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees bearing fruit, in which is their seed, each according to its kind, upon the earth. And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed according to their own kinds, and trees bearing fruit, in which is their seed, each according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, a third day. And God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. And let them be lights in the firmament of the heavens to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the great light to rule the day, the lesser light to rule the night. He made the stars also. And God set them in the firmament of the heavens to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning, a fourth day. And God said, let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the firmament of the heavens. So God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that moves, with which the waters swarm according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters and the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth. And there was evening, and there was morning, a fifth day. And God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures according to their kinds, cattle and creeping things, and beasts of the earth according to their kinds. And it was so. And God made the beasts of the earth according to their kinds, and the cattle according to their kinds, and everything that creeps upon the ground according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God he created him, male and female he created them. And God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful, and multiply, and fill the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. And God said, behold, I have given you every plant yielding of seed which is upon the face of the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food, and to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has breath of life I have given, every green plant for food. And it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, a sixth day. These are the 6 days of creation of the book of Genesis. Now, this account was not written in a cultural vacuum. In order to find out actually how unique and how special the Hebrew Bible is, on how it portrays creation, it behooves us actually to look at its competing cultures and how they presented creation. A lot of these texts were actually discovered in the 20th century, the very beginning of the 20th century, and have subsequently been more fleshed out and better understood. When these first came onto the scene, everybody started saying, nope, the Hebrew Bible just fabricated somebody else's stories. This is kind of like getting stuck on stupid, because to see the similarities of them actually highlights the dissimilarities. And when we start to see actually how creation is depicted in these ancient Babylonian, that's what the Enumelish is, or the ancient Sumerian, because there's probably a Sumerian tradition even prior to the Babylonian one, or the Ugaritic, I have two different sources we're going to show you. The picture is very drastically different. And the ancient peoples were trying to grapple with, trying to explain the world as they knew it. And the way the Hebrew Bible does it seeks to kind of dismiss their view of it. So this is how the Enuma Elish starts. This is the ancient Babylonian creation epic. Now, this was a liturgical text. It's a big poem, and it would have been read basically in their temples at their feast of the new year. So basically, when creation is recreating every year, when you go through the seasons, these kinds of things. This is how the Enuma Elish remembers the beginning of creation. It says this: "When on high the heaven had not been named, firm ground below had not been called by name, naught but primordial Apsu, their begetter, and Mumutimian, she who bore them all, their waters commingling as a single body." So the Enuma Elish starts with this picture of bitter water and sweet water, fresh water, salt water, as one big, massive thing. That's the only thing in the beginning. It's the same image as how Genesis actually starts off. The deep is actually how the book of Genesis puts it. And just so you know, the word deep in Hebrew is tehom. Okay, so it's actually a derivative of this name, a lot of people think, of Timiat, okay, who's the salt water goddess. She's feminine in the Babylonian epic. So these two waters come together. No reed hut had been matted, no marshland had appeared, when no gods whatever had been brought into being. Uncalled by name, their destinies undetermined. Then it was that the gods were formed within them. This is how the Enuma Elish starts. It starts with the formation of gods. The book of Genesis doesn't start with the formation of gods, because it isn't a myth of gods, first of all. It starts with God, and then it makes everything else. That's how Genesis starts. What the Babylonians are trying to explain is they've personified intelligible powers. If anything can be scientifically studied, it by definition is intelligible. There's a reason behind it. And so the forces of nature, according to the Babylonians, and this is basically how it's going to be for all polytheists, they basically personify. They use the image of an intelligence, which is human, and they attach it to storms, sea, different forces that behave according to a certain way and which can make life miserable or beneficial. They personify. Their creation account starts with the formation of these intelligible forces, these gods. Now, the way that the story goes, these gods don't get along very well. And they're constantly battling each other. Okay? They're trying to explain creation. And when you have creation, what do you have? You have seas that have storms like tearing them apart. Lightning bolts striking the ocean. Like, imagine if you're standing on the banks, you know, the Mediterranean. And then a big northwestern comes through, you know? You see clouds coming over, and you see lightning bolts hitting the ocean. You see what seems to be a very violent activity. Them explaining these things is that the gods themselves don't get along. Now, the formation of the world actually is going to take place, because this just describes the gods themselves we made. The formation of the world as we know it is going to result from the gods actually fighting each other. And this is how that's described in the Enuma Elish. This is the Babylonian chief god, Marduk, okay? Subsequent cultures will call him Baal. That's a phrase that we'll get in the Old Testament. And this would be the Canaanites will call him El. El Hadad, okay? El is where you get the word Elohim in the Hebrew, okay? It's the word God, okay? So this is the way that it describes, the Babylonians describe Marduk, okay? Conquering Timiat, conquering this water, and then he's going to fashion the world as we know it out of it. It goes like this. He challenges her to combat. "Stand thou up, that I and thou may meet in single combat." When Timiat heard this, she was like one possessed. She took leave of her senses. In fury, Timiat cried out aloud. To the roots Her legs shook both together. She recites a charm, keeps casting her spell, while the gods of battle sharpen their swords. Thus joined issue Timiat and Marduk, wisest of the gods. They strove in single combat, locked in battle. The Lord spread out his net to enfold her. She's a fish. Okay, so he's hunting her with a net. Because she personifies the ocean. What's in the ocean? What's living in the ocean is fish. The evil wind which blowed behind, he let loose in her face. When Timiat opened her mouth to consume him, he drove in the evil wind, that she closed not her lips. As the fierce winds charged her belly, her body was distended and her mouth was wide open. Okay, so she's this big fish and she goes to eat him. And then wind blows in her and he inflates like a balloon. That's the picture. He released the arrow, it tore her belly, it cut through her inside, splitting the heart. Having thus subdued her, he extinguished her life. He cast down her carcass to stand upon it. Then the Lord, Marduk, paused to view her dead body, that he might divide the monster and do artful works. He split her like a shellfish into two parts. Half of her he set up and sealed it as a sky, pulled down the bar and posted guards. He bade them to allow not her waters to escape. So we end up with this big fish monster, Timiat, okay, who's destroyed by Marduk and who's split in half. And the sky is made with one half of her body, and the earth is made with the other half of her body. Very quickly, people see a resemblance to the separation of the waters of Genesis day 2, okay? Except there's a big difference. Like, there's no cosmic battle in the book of Genesis. So why am I bringing these to you? Because possibly if you were an ancient Israelite, if you were Abraham who came from the city of Ur, Babylonia, okay, you were familiar with the stories of the pagans. And so when you open up the first book of Genesis, you would see the symbolic language that they're kind of using as far as the splitting of the sea, the waters, except then it's pulled. The chaotic battle is expunged from, is deleted from it. Because the main point of the story isn't necessarily how the world was made, but rather that it was made solely by God. On top of that, there is no adversarial force from which God made anything. And this is a harder concept for people to get. Because at least what the Babylonians are trying to do is they're trying to explain sometimes the violent aspects of nature. What Genesis chapter 1 gives you is there is no such thing as a violent aspect to nature. Actually, on top of that, it's all good. What we perceive of as violent in nature is actually part of God's order. It's not a result of a cosmic battle. It's rather the way God has ordained it. And he's ordained everything good. Here's an Ugaritic myth depicting a similar thing. Now, we only have this thing in parts. We've never found the entirety of this myth. But in a couple of verses, and these ones I think are pretty important for us to know. Again, this was discovered in 1930. So Marduk, the chief god, is Baal, but he's describing actually this battle of God with the negative god, the evil god, or the hostile god, who is always personified as water, okay? What enemies risen against Baal? What foe against the rider of clouds? That is a phrase that is going to be used in the book of Psalms describing Elway, okay? The rider of clouds. Crushed I not El's beloved Yam, okay? Yam is the Hebrew word for sea. Destroyed I not El's flood, Rabim, okay? That's a title that we're going to find in the Hebrew Bible too, Rabim. Did I not pray muzzle the dragon? So these three names are parallels. Sea, Rabin, some kind of name for the sea monster, a dragon. Now, how does he describe this dragon? I did crush the crooked serpent, Shiloh, the seven-headed sea serpent. Okay. And there's probably a reason why in the book of Revelation there's a dragon that comes out of the sea and it has seven heads. Okay. like these mythical images are going to be used in the Bible in other places. Not in Genesis chapter 1, but they're there in the culture. Here's another one. If thou smite Lotan, the serpent's slant, destroy the serpent's torturous Shylot of the seven heads. Okay, again. Now here's another name for him, Lotan, or her, Lotan. This is probably, most people think, a derivative of what we call Leviathan, the big sea monster. Here are some famous ones from the Hebrew Bible, Psalm 74. I paralleled these so you can actually see the similarities. Thou by thy strength, this is Psalm 74, didst make the sea firm, thou didst crush the heads of the dragons in the waters. Thou hast broken the heads of the dragon, thou hast given him to meat for the people of the Ethiopians. Thou hast broken up the fountains and the torrents, thou hast dried up the Ethan rivers. So here you have this picture in Psalm 74 of God destroying some kind of sea dragon. Okay? Not only that, it has seven heads. And he crushes it. And he makes firm the water, makes the water into land. Psalm 74. Isaiah 27. In that day the Lord with his hard and great and strong sword shall visit Leviathan, the bar serpent, and Leviathan, the crooked serpent, and shall slay the whale that is in the sea. Well, here you have Leviathan with crooked serpent, which is really interesting because in this other one you have Lotan with the serpent tortuous, circuitous, the twisty serpent. It seems almost that Isaiah actually knows that myth and he's actually citing it, using it. Now, I just gave you two examples. I hope I put the things... Sometimes looking at artistic representations of some of these things, it's almost as if artists have a keener insight into the original sense of the scripture, even though they didn't know the ancient cultural context, just because they have a furtive imagination. These are famous wood carvings, okay, from the 19th century. So this is before these ancient myths were discovered, okay? Gustave Doré, pretty famous. This is his day five, the making of the fish and the fowl. Okay, so you have the birds up in the sky, and this is his big sea monster. Okay, his dragon, the great sea monster, the one. This is the recounting of it in his artwork for the same Genesis day five in his Paradise Lost. Again, you have, like, he's not trying to make a whale. He's not trying to give you a natural representation of the book of Genesis. He's actually trying to get into what Genesis is trying to actually portray. Like, this thing God made. The great sea monster. The one that's built into this whole cultural context. But he did this actually prior to its discovery. These are all biblical references to all these names we just saw from these other Ugaritic and also from the Babylonian creation epic. All these names, Rahab, Leviathan, dragon, also in Hebrew it's Tanin, the sea, Yam, death, behemoth, the deep. These two weren't directly referenced, but from their parallel sections, they seem to be personified chaos. Now notice, these are all the biblical references. Isaiah, from the Psalms, from Ezekiel, some references in Exodus, from Habakkuk, Hosea. Look at it all from Job. Like, Job is like just chock full of them. Job is probably, in some sense, uses actually the most mythic language there is. Now for our intents and purposes, what's important for us to understand is all these references are coming from poetical sources of a time later on when Israel's not really believing in the cosmic chaos battle. In a certain sense, Genesis chapter 1 doesn't seek to expunge the culture, or like it can't remove the language or the way people have depicted artistically creation, but it seeks to teach monotheism. But those cultural references of the cosmic chaos battle, if you will, reverberate still through the Bible. and are used for effect, like in the book of Isaiah. Like Isaiah will use it. He's not speaking historically, he's speaking metaphorically, as poetry is wont to do. Job is probably one of the most difficult books in the Bible. One of the reasons why is because it speaks with so much mythic signs. If you want to use Augustine's terms, like the ancient myths become signs for something else. And yeah, absolutely. Like in the Christian context, like all these things, Rahab, Leviathan, the dragon, and yeah, even the sea, like who does it get personified as? Like Satan. It becomes the satanic figure. This is the same artist. His depiction of from the book of Job, of God battling Leviathan, because that's what's described in the book of Job. In the, I think it's the 40th chapter? In the 40th chapter of the book of Job. Now he made this before those sources were found, but actually, after reading the sources, you look at this, you're like, yeah, that makes sense. It's like he's actually depicting what a later story is revealed to have said. This I find fascinating. I just found this one not too long ago. This is a manuscript from the 15th century. This is Christian, okay? 15th century. On this manuscript, this is a Psalter, and this is for Psalm 68. But these are the images that are on it. Okay, so you have Jonah getting spit out of a big whale, huh? In the sea. Okay. Remember, he got swallowed up because he was trying to disobey God's law. Okay, and then he gets spewed out on the ground. Down here, you have Tobit, who is delivered from a big fish. Whenever people are going to Assyria, a big fish attacks them. I'm just saying, because Jonah's supposed to go to Assyria, Nineveh. Okay, and a whale eats him on his way there. Tobit is trying to go there too. Big fish attacks him, and Raphael has to deliver him from him. Now notice, like, it's depicting the big fish the same. Now this is what I find, like, absolutely, like, fascinating. This is awesome. So, this probably isn't even in the video. This is Matthew 8:24. This is the storm at the sea. Christ asleep in the boat. Hey, we perish, the apostles. Okay, the sea's about to eat them. This little guy, this is not in the New Testament. But this guy like sees the similarities of like the ocean, that the danger of the ocean is depicted by the sea monster, and they throw a sea monster down here underneath the ship, seeking to eat it. Okay? Now what's really cool is, I gotta keep thinking about this, but what's really cool is this all illuminates Psalm 68. And this is how Psalm 68 starts. Save me, O God, for the waters have come up to my neck. I sink in deep mire, where there is no foothold. I have come into deep waters, and the flood sweeps over me. I am weary with my crying, my throat is parched, my eyes go dim with waiting for my God. It depicts somebody dying in the water. Okay? Somebody dying in the water. Psalm 68 is one of the crucifixion psalms. It prophesies different aspects of Christ's crucifixion. This is how, actually, the crucifixion is depicted in the book of the Psalter. Of Christ going into the sea, of dying in the sea. Okay. So, let's get back to our prologue. So I told you, Timiot, is Tehom a reference to her? Maybe. But the whole point is that she's just there and the Spirit of God moved over the waters. Now it is true spirit, the Ruach, I can't do the whole guttural Hebrew thing. Could also mean wind, and so the Ruach Elohim could be mighty wind, okay? But the fact is that it moved over the waters, it hovered, okay? The word there is like hovered over the waters, kind of like how an eagle hovers over its nest. There is no conflict here at all. That's really important for this, the author of this. It's actually everything is controlled. Now, Augustine tries to grapple with, what the heck does the world look like right here? This is why I never depicted it. I couldn't even depict it. I don't know how it's supposed to look. Because it's described as void and empty. This phrase, tohu vavohu, is only used one other time in the Old Testament, and it's in the book of Jeremiah. It means, you could call it, it's poetical, so you could call it welter or waste, but it's Augustine, in his Confessions, when he tries to grapple with this beginning state of the world, he's trying to visualize something that is completely formless, which by definition is unimaginable. Like, you can't put a shape to it. As soon as you put a shape to it, it has a form. Like, what is it? And there's no light, it's dark. So it's something incomprehensible. Before God does anything, it's incomprehensible. Augustine kind of describes it like prime matter, like pure potency, if you will. But it's like, it's unformed. How do you depict something that's formless, chaos, if you will? Well, to tell you the truth, you can use two things. One, darkness. Darkness, by definition, is unintelligible because it's the absence of everything. Most of your information comes through sight. True. Sound is very powerful. It's the only way you have light in the night is with your ears. Darkness, no image. Okay. What does water do? Water resists having a shape, right? It's constantly moving. Okay. This is what the signs signify. It tries to signify something that we actually can't imagine. We have to clothe it within something, and the most powerful symbol to describe disorder is going to be water and darkness. And these are meta symbols, okay? Because anything disordered could be used with those two signs. Like death, we just saw a psalm using death described as water. You losing your shape and disintegrating, huh? Going back to a formless state, if you will. Or darkness, absolutely. Not only physical death, those who sit under the shadow of death, huh? As Isaiah says, but also moral death, huh? Darkness of sin, the disorderness, like those are meta symbols for to be applied. They're metaphors. To prove the point, actually, the meta symbol, I guess, God made light, okay? The darkness is already fait accompli. Darkness is there. He made light, okay? And light was made. And God saw that the light was good. This is the only day that God names the thing as good. He names light as good. Every other day, well, not the second day, but every day other than the second day, it says, and God saw that it was good, it was good, it was good. On day one, the light is good. Why? Because darkness is nothing. Darkness is the absence of light. It's a meta symbol. God did not make the darkness. The darkness is where God is not. That is simple. On the third day, this is another way that our chapter 1 seeks to be a polemic, seeks to like argue against the pagan creation myths in a certain sense. Like, it seeks to actively resist them. Like, it uses plural here. The waters that were gathered together he called seas. Like, why is the plural used here? Well, I just showed you yam, which is how you say sea, the sea, in Hebrew, is also a name for a Canaanite god. And so instead, our author here uses the plural seas so that you can't confuse it with the Canaanite god, if you will. Okay? Like, this is not a personified thing. This is a part of creation. They're together. They're the seas. On the fourth day, with the making of the lights, hey, man, every culture seems to divinize the lights, and there's a good reason for that. I mean, all life, in a certain sense that we know it, like, if the sun went away, everything would die. And seeing how darkness is bad, well, like, the source of light is really good. Well, the Canaanite word, I mean, their word for sun and their word for moon were the names of personified gods. And Hebrew knows those words, and the Bible will use them, but in Genesis chapter 1, it refuses to use them. Instead, what's it do? It says greater light and lesser light. It doesn't want to use the word sun, and it doesn't want to use the word moon. To be unequivocal, God didn't make lesser gods, okay? And I really like how it just, kind of like as the last thing, so it's like, he made the stars also. Like, I mean, the stars were the wandering stars, the planets, divinized by everybody. Our guy just wants us to know, hey, look at greater light, lesser light. I'm not even going to use the name that we use popularly, just so we know that they're not gods. On the fifth day, he does something interesting on the fifth day, because he doesn't shy from using the whole sea monster thing. Which, considering what we just went through about how he changes the names for seas and these other things, he leaves in the great sea monster, okay? Which is why I think it becomes like the perfect metaphor for all subsequent generations to describe malevolence. Something intelligible with an evil heart. Yeah, okay, fine. In Christianity, it's going to be the devil. If you're a Jew in exile, it's going to be the king of Babylon. I mean, but the sea monster, that thing that dwells in the chaos and the unshaped matter, in the dark, okay, it uses those symbols that we've already seen that are negative. It has it here, okay? But it says, but it uses a very powerful word. It goes, so God created the great sea monsters. It uses the word created here to let you know that this is not like a Manichaean concept. Okay? There's not dual gods. Everything flowed from the one God. He created it. We're going to see, he only uses the word created in Genesis chapter 1. Within the very first verse, with these, the fishies, and then with man. Everything else, it's going to be formed or fabricated or separated or gathered or made, but created, strong word. Our guy throws it right here too. God made it too. Okay? There's not two great gods. There's one God. Everything else is derivative of him. Okay, so that's like a polemical aspect of Genesis chapter 1. Trying to really get at monotheism and to vaccinate people in the proper thinking of what creation is. Now, its overarching theme, after the fact that God made everything, is going to be that everything is actually well-ordered. Everything in it is well-ordered. And it's going to do this through the symbol of seven. Okay, seven, this is not a pure Hebrew concept. Like almost all Middle Eastern cultures use seven as like a perfect number. And Hebrews exist in that culture, and they use it too. Their word for perfect and or full is almost equivocal. It looks exactly the same as the word for seven. Okay. So the sevens of our chapter. I mean, it becomes so obvious. Okay, just in the very first sentence. In the beginning, God created heaven and earth. The first sentence of the Bible. The three nouns in it. Elohim is used 35 times throughout the 7 days. Okay, 7 times 5. Heaven is going to be used 21 times, 7 times 3. Earth is going to be used 21 times, 7 times 3. 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7. Everything's going to be sevens. First verse is going to be composed of 7 words. The second verse is going to be composed of 14 words. Okay? Its form is going to be the form of Genesis, the 7 days of creation, is going to be more dictated by the author's desire of giving you a sevenfold perfect conception of the world. Not necessarily the sequence or the material fabrication of the world, that is all secondary to the form of this prose here at the beginning. Wants these sevens in there. Light, or it's what it's called day in the first day, it's mentioned 7 times. Water is referenced 7 times in paragraphs 2 and 3. Beasts are referenced 7 times in 5 and 6. It was good is referenced 7 times. The 7th paragraph, which is the 7th day, has 3 sentences, each formed of 7 words, and has the 7th day in the middle expression. 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7. Lots of sevens. I'm recording this, okay, so you guys can like get the notes later on if you need to. Okay. But don't slack. Okay, so there's a beautiful artistry. It wants you to know that every single aspect of creation is perfect. And it's doing this. It's perfect and comes from God. And it's doing this primarily, the way I see it at least, through the reverberation of, or the repetition, of using terms by derivatives of seven. This is what you call a deep reading of Genesis chapter 1. Now, this is the 6 days. I let the seventh off because I couldn't fit it in there. These are the 6 days. Now, I want you to consider this. This is how it secondarily shows you its order. Day one, okay? God makes light. On these days, you end up with like acts of making something and then distinctions, okay? And so you have lights made and then you have day and night, okay? On its corresponding day, okay, that's the thing, is you need to be seeing these things as there's 3 days and then they have subsequently 3 days, okay? They're parallels. So day and night are the distinguished things of day one. On day four, what's made? Lights and the firmament of the heavens for the day and for the night. So basically the denizens, the things that dwell in the areas of distinction are created on its corresponding day. On day two, you have the waters above and below, okay? What's made is the firmament. And the firmament actually creates the sky. Its corresponding day, what do you have? You have the fish and the birds. So you have the formation of the sky and the waters, and here you have the fish and the birds. This is what our author wants us to see. This is how he's formally actually showing you an ordered creation. Dry land, earth, okay, and vegetation. A subsequent thing is made on this day. It's interesting, okay? What do you have here? You have those that dwell on earth, beasts of the earth, all their different kinds, creepy crawlers, all kinds of things. And then you have an additional thing made, man, okay? So not only is like something special made here, okay, vegetation, then something special is made there, man, okay, but on top of that, this special thing already anticipates man because this special thing is man's food, as is said at the bottom of day six, okay? Like he's given vegetation to eat. This is made for man. I would also think there's also something kind of powerful here. Like everybody knows there's a big difference between like a rock and a flower or a fruit tree that multiplies itself, okay? That has a life principle. Like there's a big chasm in between dry earth and vegetation, fruit trees. Pay attention to your parallelism, then you should understand, wow, there's a big difference between a beast and a man. As big of a difference as between a rock and an apple tree. It's debatable for some men, but it's supposed to be a huge difference. Okay, another way that we can put this, this is my little schematic design here. Okay, you have the days. You have a divine action, creation of light, distinction, day, night. Formation of firmament, waters above, waters below. Gathering of waters, sprouting vegetation, sea, verdant earth. And then the denizens, luminaries, fish, fowl, land, beasts, and man. So, a perfect creation, a well-ordered creation. The form itself dictates it. This is how we're supposed to interpret Genesis chapter 1. Which has serious consequences of when we dwell in a very chaotic world sometimes, it seems like. Be it storms or natural disasters, all kinds of things. Though things appear to us to be very disorganized or tending towards dissolution, according to Genesis chapter 1, not so. That's not the framework of creation. Framework of creation is ordered, made by God, consequently good. This is to illustrate, just by paying attention to the verbs that it uses. Separated, made, gathered, okay? This is God shaping and placing things in order. I think this is going to be really important because this carries over actually into how man himself starts to act like God. And in the next chapter, he starts naming things and separating animals in a certain sense. But it's not just that God makes things, okay? But he also disposes things to be in a certain way, in a certain place. That's really important because to be out of your place is to be disordered, to be wrong. The fact that it uses these verbs, though, is also to highlight the fact that when it uses created, he does so for an artistic effect. Okay? God created heavens and earth, great sea monsters, triple created on man. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. Okay? Obviously, triple redundancy for effect. And you can definitely tell what's the high point of creation of the 6 days is actually going to be the sixth day of man. Man's the only one that gets this kind of really powerful repetition. It's obviously signaled out. Here's a little thing that's a little bit more mysterious, if you will. I find it mysterious. Some people don't think it's that mysterious, but I really do. Whenever we find patterns, okay, this is one of the things, one of the reasons why I'm reading it this way, so you can understand actually like how to pay attention. We typically check out when we see things repeating. We're like, oh, wow, this is boring. Like, I already know this. Like, okay. You're boring. Not the Bible. Don't think like that. When you find patterns, what you're supposed to be doing is you're paying attention to how they change in surprising ways. Because that tells you something. The absence of a pattern highlights itself. Okay, so here, there's an obvious pattern. Every day ends with the giving of the number. On the first day, but that's the thing, it doesn't say first day, it says one day. Then it says second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth, and seventh. You have ordinal numbers, but then you have a cardinal number for the first one. What the heck is one day? Why does it say first day? Like, it's bizarre. Well, there's one way you can interpret it, but I find this highly unpoetic. But one way you can interpret it is like, because at the conclusion of five, there is no other day expected. So it just gives one day. But then after you have the second day, well, now you have an established sequence. So you switch to an ordinal number instead of a cardinal. But every time we use lists, we're like, we don't do it that way. If you start the first day thinking there's going to be a consequent day, you start with first, knowing there's this whole unfolding plan. So maybe the one day as a unit is actually, this is just me so you can throw it away, is maybe actually a sign, if you will, a figurative expression of actually what the totality of creation is going to be ultimately ordered towards. Okay? I think that's definitely how John's going to use it in the beginning of his gospel, because he equates the light with Christ. In the beginning was the Word was God. Right? And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness does not comprehend it. And then you end up the sons of light, if you will. Those are born of grace and truth. Okay? Who in the great end of time will go to the celestial abode where there is no more night, as the book of Apocalypse tells us. Because the Lamb will be there and he will be our light. And they'll be forever separated from the sons of darkness, if you will. I mean, Genesis day one gives us a snapshot, if you will. God makes light. Certain people dwell on the light. Others dwell on the darkness. The two end up separated and never mix again. One day. That's one way of reading it. Am I reading into it? Maybe a little bit, but there's something there. I don't know why that's there. This is what I wanted to do. Okay. The light was good. Again, huge emphasis on the light, which plays in my one day thing, I think. Other days, it was good. It was good. It was good. It was good. It was very good. There's seven it was goods. There's not an it was good on here. Okay? The Greek version of the Bible thought this was a mistake, and so they added it on there. Okay? Not cool. Because they have eight now instead of seven. We want seven. Seven's important. So, but what's not good here? Let me ask you that. I mean, it breaks it. It breaks the pattern. Why does our author break the pattern here? And he goes, there's nothing good on this day. Now, one way you can interpret it is because he isn't done moving the waters, because he gathers them on this day. So this is a work in progress. It's not just separating waters above and below, but it's also they need to be gathered together. Okay? Actually, the water separating is just so the land could appear eventually. That's when it's good. And then you get the double good, because it's vegetation also. That's one way you can interpret it. But again, what does the firmament do? That's what's made on this day. It separates the heavens and the earth. Whoa. It's interesting. I would maintain the heavens and the earth, the pontifex, if you will, the bridge between the heavens and the earth actually gets made on the sixth day, because it's man who has his head in the clouds and his feet on the earth. But this idea of the separation, if you will, of heavens and earth, I'm going to hold a moral note on that one. They're not necessarily supposed to be separated. That's one way you can interpret it. That's how I kind of interpret it. I haven't actually read that anywhere, but it makes kind of sense to me. So that's why one of the reasons why it's really important to pay attention to patterns. Another thing that's kind of neat is that blessing is given on man and on the water. Okay, so you can see, now I'll give you like Christian commentary, if you will. Like Christian commentary will make a big deal about the 6 days. Sometimes they do it in a very sequential kind of format. Other times they completely allegorize it. St. John Chrysostom saw the 6 days as a complete prophecy for salvation history. Hence why, like, man is made on the sixth day. You got to understand, what is the sixth day? The sixth day is Friday. That's the day man's redeemed, okay? The waters are blessed. Why are waters blessed? Because it's actually through the water that baptism redeems man, okay? In a certain sense, all life comes from water, okay? That's exactly actually how day four tells us. Everything comes from water. Some things take wing and fly. Other things go down to the deeps. So think of that for a second. You either live in the water or you properly die to the water. And if you properly die to the water, you go up to the heavens. You become a bird. To the blessed water. That's how Chrysostom will see it. Like baptism makes fish into birds. If you will. I mean, that's what he kind of says. That's a very close reading of Genesis chapter 1. But it's kind of like, it's kind of cool. I kind of like it. What else do I want to tell you from this day? I think I covered everything I wanted to cover. Are there any questions? I should say, yeah, it seems to be a man was a vegetarian at the beginning, but don't tell anybody that. Because then everyone's going to think we're supposed to be vegetarians now. It changes after the flood, after the second creation. I do want to show you this, okay? Like, okay, this is... my thing. This is my artistic representation of the 6 days of creation, okay? Like, yeah, I like my Leviathan, okay? Like, it's a sea monster. That's cool. And he's eating a fish, because I think that's important. Because if you don't, like, become a bird, you get eaten by the Leviathan, okay? Not cool. So we got to die with Christ so that we can live with him. Fly away, up to the heavens, cool. Okay. And since I can, I put woman on the dark side. Because we all know how chapter 3 is going to be. But why did I make this thing? This is going to be your key. If I can teach you this, this will actually help you out so much more going into the future. And because Augustine is right. Like, in a certain sense, we have to let the Bible describe to us what it wants to describe to us in its terms. And we have to be extremely, extremely humble in what it's telling us. And so, in order to enter into actually what properly to think about the Bible, the easiest way to actually get to the meaning is if you radically, this is what I call radical imagination. It describes something, you have to picture it. Don't try using an analog from nature. You let it describe how it's trying to describe it. If you get the right image in your head, that's the closest you can have to actually entering into the culture in a certain sense. Okay? Because most of the time they're going to be using metaphors and stuff, but you have to have the right image to look through. So, if you depict creation this way, you know, man and woman, day and night, fish and fowl, waters above, waters below, and then on the outside, light and darkness, like, it's ordered. It's distinct. It's separated. It makes sense. Right? And so, let it describe. There's nothing that I like. It's like a knife in my heart when I hear people like trying to read modern day physics back into the Bible. Like, it's not trying to describe that. Let it give you the image. Don't impose an image on Scripture. Let Scripture give you the image. And it's going to be in the image that you can derive true senses as best you can. This is going to be really true when it comes to the poetry sections. The prophets. Like, the prophets are, like, so complicated. But if you're looking at the image, you can come up with, like, that, which actually is what's depicted later on in the Bible. Like, this guy did a good job. In some sense. Okay? Yes, ma'am.
Who was the artist of that?
That is Gustave Doré. I don't know if I accented that right because I don't know French. Gustave Doré. And you know what? This guy, my favorite guy, this guy, anonymous. No one knows who the heck this guy is. But this guy is an artistic genius. I'm just saying. This is genius. In the baptismal rite, I always make reference to this, and everyone thinks like I'm just making stuff up. But in the baptismal rite, when you do an exorcism over the child, those of you who have been to my baptism know exactly what I'm about to say. When you do an exorcism on the child, you say, May he who pulled Peter out of the water defeat you or cast you out. Because whenever you use God's name, you always have to use some kind of a positive describing how powerful he is. That's very scriptural. Well, in exorcism for baptism, the symbol for God's power is actually Christ who walks on the water and pulls life out of the water. Peter, symbolized by Peter. The stormy sea. So this idea of like this being the devil's domain, true. You're either going to get eaten by that fish or Christ is going to be pulling you out. How do you get pulled out of the water? Baptism. And that's central mystery of Christianity is you actually have to die to the world in order to rise with Christ. You have to actually go into the water with him. Okay. Anyway. I love that. Okay. Let's pray. I'm over? Yeah, I'm over. Hey, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. Glory be to the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Benedictio Deum tentis in a patris et filius virtus sancti, et super vos et mani semper. Amen. May Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Our Lady, Seat of Wisdom, in the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, amen. All right, so let us delve into chapter 2 and 3. That's my goal today. So, to recap the last lecture, I love this picture, huh? It's like, oh yeah. Like, he's looking at you. He's indicting himself. He knows what's going on. Here's little serpents hanging from the tree. Fascinating stuff. Okay, chapter 1. Chapter 1, the main thrust of the way that it was put together was that the world is well ordered, everything has its place, and everything is good. There's a couple things I forgot to stress. One is, I think it's significant, especially in subsequent use of Genesis chapter 1, which again is only 7 paragraphs, and it's kind of amazing how frequently it's going to be used throughout the rest of Scripture. It is really one of the most important chapters of the entire book, this prologue to salvation history, this six-day account of creation's history, if you will. One of the things I think is quite important, a detail, is that everything God makes, He makes during the light, during daylight. Everything is, all of creation is going to be marked through the lens of light, because it's only during the day that God creates, okay? Things are void in form, or how does it say it? How does our thing say it? The earth was without form and void. The first 3 days filled the void, because He created these spaces in which then things were formed within those, okay? So the void is filled by the creation of habitats, and then the formlessness of those habitats gets populated by denizens, okay? Be they the luminaries, be they the fish and the fowl, be they the beast, and then man. Man, if we paid attention to actually how those 6 days work, the creation itself is a series of concentric circles. This kind of was in my picture that I had made for it, where you have the luminaries, and then you have like fish, which is down low in the abyss, but then also birds, which are up in the sky, and then you had like the land creatures, and then on the sixth day, in the very center of this spatial circle of creation, you end up with man, okay? One other way the artistry itself is trying to emphasize actually the peculiar and special, unique place man has as the center of creation, okay? Not just man, but He gave us the triple created, made in man's God's image, male and female, He created them. Okay? The two gender of mankind in the center, this pair, in the center of all creation. Man is formed in the image of God. That kind of carries a certain consequence. To be in the image of God means man stands as the physical presence of God on earth. Okay, like man is God's representative in the middle of this palace, if you will, of what creation is. And He has dominion. That's where man's dominion flows from. It's because he's made in God's image. No other creature is made in God's image. Therefore, nothing else can have dominion over man. There's only one thing that has dominion over man, and that's God Himself. Because man is just the image of God. He is not God. Okay, this is how we understand man in God's creation. Okay, He has a peculiar role of being like God to creation. Okay, but He Himself has God above Him. I find it a very peculiar thing that the luminaries aren't, it doesn't seem that the luminaries are put under the domain of man, the sun, the moon, the stars, etc. Those things are put up there in the firmament to rule the day and the night. Man is put underneath the firmament in order to rule the fish, the fowl, and all the beasts of the earth. I think, and this is kind of me a little bit, we will find out later on in Scripture that the luminaries, the stars, and the sun, and the moon seem to fall outside the prohibition of Israel making images of God. Yeah. Like, Israel will seem to incorporate the celestial bodies as almost like natural icons of God. You find it a lot in like the poetry sections where And the church, I think, actually completely assumes this too. Like certain psalms, which talks about, may the countenance of your face illumine me. Like what we sing that at Lauds. Actually, I said that this morning at Lauds when I recited it. I forget what psalm it is now. But what's illuminating my face at dawn? Like the sun itself. Like the sun is like an image of God. Okay? It's a natural icon of God. For this reason, the New Testament, like the sun darkens when Christ dies. Okay? Christ is the true light of the world. So but when he dies, that which symbolizes him also goes dark. At the very end of the Bible, the sun and moon go away. Why? Because now the true light is back. Okay? Christ. So the sun is kind of like a natural symbol for God. And Israel seems like they will use it that way. At least there's some evidence of it. It's called solar Yahwism. Not that they idolized the God, but that it was like a natural image of what man can use in order to reflect on God. This is built into our Eastern orientation of liturgy. That's what the sun rises in the east. It's a nice pun in English. The S-O-N rises in the east, and we wait for the S-O-N to come again from the east. Okay, but that pun doesn't work in Hebrew, but it works in English. But it's the same thing. I think for this reason, and the stars are all over the place, are going to be kind of referred to as angels in the Old Testament and in the New. The third of the stars in the sky fall in the book of the Apocalypse. At the beginning of the book of the Apocalypse, John sees a man. He has seven stars in his hand. The seven stars represent the seven angels over the seven churches. Like, stars will represent angels in subsequent scriptural texts. What's another one? The Epistle Jude calls the wandering stars planetai, planets, demons. Okay, why? Because they don't obey, like, they don't go in perfect circles. They like to abandon their path. They do this weird transitus thing. That's what planets do. They're wandering stars. So stars are going to become like images, if you will, of angels. These lights in the darkness, if you will. I think for that reason, it also lends itself that these things aren't ruled by God, by man, because they're images of higher powers that rule over man. Man can't control the seasons and the times. He can't stop time. All these things man is subject to. And so anyways, the luminaries aren't under man's control, per se. Then lastly, we get to the seventh day. The seventh day was important. We didn't cover it, but this is basically what the seventh day said. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished. How were they finished? Were they done completely? And all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God finished his work which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all his work which he had done in creation. Okay? Now, this is not saying that the relative to the cosmos creation has been done. All pieces are now set. But that doesn't mean the process itself by which creation continues to be governed and God continues to provide for it ceases on the seventh day. Now, I think there could be, and definitely later Jewish interpreters viewed this as the seventh day as a prophecy of a future time of like eternal beatitude, of when we will be perfectly at rest. And there's no sunset on the seventh day. This idea that we will be in this perfect light on the seventh day, that never experienced any darkness, ergo read in all the negative things that darkness can symbolize, be it sin and ignorance and death. Jewish commentators actually would say that the light made on Genesis day one was a special light that was reserved later on for this seventh day, so that we don't get access to that first light that's separated from the darkness. You only get that when you finally reach the seventh day. In our liturgical worship, the reason why we rest on the seventh day is actually the spirit of the Sabbath comes from Genesis chapter 1, the seventh day, this perfect day. When God rests from his creation because it's done, okay, when the task has now been finished, this is supposed to be an image for us to be able to rest at the end of our life when our task too is finished, if our conduct in creation reflects God's creation itself, meaning everything is in the right proper place and order, and it is very good. that is so, we kind of reach a moral harmony or tranquility, and that translates into having perfect rest in the hereafter. We rest with God on the seventh day. So every Sunday, what we do, so from apostolic tradition, Saturday gets moved to Sunday, which is the first day of creation. That's an important thing for you to understand. Sunday is not the seventh day here. Sunday is actually the first day here. But we ourselves look forward to this final day, this final seventh day, when all things will be at rest. We are restless until that day happens. So Sunday is our time to actually remind ourselves of that which we are ultimately seeking. That's what Sunday is supposed to be about. I know, it's fun. We can go do sports and do all this other stuff. But Sunday is about having like fun, recreation. Okay. That's not necessarily what the spirit of Sunday is. What the spirit of Sunday is that's your day for leisure, of raising your mind in contemplation of God, of giving adoration and worship to Him, because that is what you will do in heaven. You will contemplate God for all eternity in heaven. Okay? If that doesn't sound like a good time, that's because you don't have a good concept of God or yourself. But that is what heaven is. That's what Sunday is supposed to be a sign of, a symbol of. So we hollow one day a week looking forward to that ultimate day of the end of the week of time itself, okay? When everything will be at rest and there will be no more sunset. We will rest with God. Use Augustine's term, like, our hearts are restless until they rest in thee. Well, that's when our hearts will rest with Him. When we finally enter our Sabbath rest at the end of our life. If, again, we're well harmonized with God's creation. That's the other aspect of God's creation. And this is void of the ancient Middle Eastern accounts of creation. Where you have Marduk, like, destroying the hostile forces of the ancient, like, sea goddess, okay, and making creation out of her carcass. You have all this, like, order out of chaos in the ancient Middle Eastern creation stories. But the thing of Genesis chapter 1, it's not just that creation takes place, but there's a moral quality to it. The fact that it's constantly saying it is good, it is good, it is good, and it does this seven times, there's a moral quality to creation. Like, good and bad are two different concepts here that you don't actually get in the other creation epics. But for the Hebrew Bible, God creates out of just His sheer dint of speaking. That has serious repercussions for Christianity, whose the second person is called the Word. God creates out of speaking, and not only that, He creates with a moral note. He creates things that are good. And everything is good. This is going to force Augustine to say evil, the nature of evil is going to be a privation of a good. Because evil doesn't actually come into God's creation. It's an absence, it's a void created by something else in creation. By man. Well, that moral character is going to get translated into the next chapter that we go into. But that's important. There's a moral quality to creation, according to the Hebrew, according to our faith. Okay, so then we go to the second chapter proper. These are the generations of the heaven and the earth when they were created. It is really important for you to mark this verse off. Can you fix my projector? I don't know why. Somebody keeps moving it every time you turn it on. There you go. Okay, so brackets. See how I put a bracket there with a one? You got to put that in your Bible, okay? So this verse right here, these are the generations. This word generations is going to be used. It's going to be used on repeated intervals throughout the book of Genesis. Almost, if you're going to find any natural like chapter divisions according to the original author or the compiler of these stories, I think it's probably the most likely candidate is going to be signaled by these verses. Okay, these are the generations of the heavens and the earth. It's going to a couple chapters later. It's going to be these are the generations of Adam. A couple chapters after that, it will be these are the generations of Shem. Like these verses are going to signal new movements in the narrator's cycle. Okay, so this is like a framing verse. This is an important. This is telling you we're now entering something new. Now let's pay attention here. In the day that the Lord God made the heavens and the earth. Okay, most of your Bibles will put a title on it saying, another account of creation. Yeah, mine does that. I don't know if the Dewey does anything. Does the Dewey say anything? No. No. Okay. Cool Dewey. Now, it's going to relate a creation account. But that doesn't mean it's one in opposition to the one we just read. Okay? I think that's a little bit forced. If there's another account, the point is that a subsequent author put these two things together for a purpose. And so I guess you could maintain there's two separate traditions that then get harmonized or something like that, but I think all that is teased. We're looking at one work of art. Genesis chapter 1 and 2 actually do belong together. Probably a better way of thinking about it is chapter 1 is a panorama of creation, and then chapter 2 is a really hyper-focused aspect on man's creation. And you can see that like a scene of a movie. First you take in the whole thing, the whole setting, and then you telescope in. Well, I say this thing telescopes in, and it shows you the very first verse of chapter 1 was, in the beginning, God created heavens and earth. Okay, pay attention to your terms here. I said, whenever you find a repetition, pay attention to how it changes. Because now it says, in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens. It's completely shifted these terms. It went from looking up all the way down to the earth, the heavens of the earth. Now all of a sudden it shifts the order of these and says, made the earth and the heavens. The emphasis is on earth now, going up to the heavens. And on top of that, the name God has now shifted to Lord God. Whenever you see this capital Lord, what I think the Dewey does this too. Does it do the capital Lord? Yeah? Okay. Whenever you see this capital Lord, this is... What's behind that is the name revealed to Moses, Yahweh. The Hebrews would never say Yahweh. They would just... They had different words that they would say. One of them is Adonai, which is Lord. So... What is written is different than what is spoken. That's interesting. Like the spoken tradition is more important than the written tradition in this case. And so what is written is actually never read. When you see the name Yahweh in Hebrew, you would just say Adonai. And so that's what's written here, is what's the spoken tradition. So this is important. This is the personal name of God all of a sudden shows up in this creation account. Okay? Now, in that day is just a Hebrew idiom that means at that time or in the time. So instead of in the beginning, the big panorama of all creation, now it's going at the time when the Lord God made the earth and the heavens. Now it's focusing in on this other aspect of creation, the making of man on the earth. But this is signaling something, a much different focus. The Lord God, this is his personal name, one revealed to Moses. That means... What we're about to hear is going to be the proper subject matter of Revelation, okay? This is the personal story of God and man. Not God as a supreme creator. That's like natural theology. I like to think, actually. Genesis chapter 1 actually tells you what even the pagans find out, that one God made everything, okay? But Aristotle wouldn't be able to tell you that that God's name is Yahweh and that he formed man and personally bequeath to him certain graces. That's what chapter 2 is about. God's relationship with man. Chapter 1, God's relationship with the world, with the cosmos. Chapter 2, the emphasis is going to be on man. Let's go. When no plant of the field was yet in the earth, and no herb of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was no man to till the ground. But a mist went up from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground. So there's no rain. That's an important fact. So the garden image that we're going to start having depicted, I didn't stress maybe this enough either, but like water is a twofold symbol. It's either bad or good. And normally, like, this ocean is always bad. There's only one time in the entire Old Testament that the Hebrews actually build ships to sail in the ocean because they hated the ocean. Salt water is always bad because it kills you. If you drink it, you can't live in it. But also, like, rain is really unpredictable. I mean, it's either flooding or there's a drought. Like, rain is unpredictable. And so it's not normally a positive aspect of water either. The one exception to water being positive is going to be water that comes from the ground. This is always going to be the case. Like a spring, good. A well, good. Mist or dew, good. Like these are the beneficial waters. These are the positive, life-giving waters. Rivers flow from the earth. So water that comes from the earth are going to be good. Waters that come from like anywhere else or are not part of the earth are going to be typically bad. They have to be moved in order for life to exist. God had to move the waters in order for life to come. So there's no rain. This garden is not going to be watered by rain. Instead, mist comes up out of the earth and waters the whole face of the ground. So the earth is being watered not through rain. It's being watered by subterranean fresh water, okay? Spring. It's likening it to mist. The Lord God formed man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And man became a living soul. This is the formation of man. No, before I do the man thing, I'm going to skip over here for a second, actually. We're going to have he's going to go into like the four rivers that flow out of the garden. So here we have a mist coming up, watering the whole earth. Then it's going to focus in on this. This water gathering in the garden and flowed out of Eden, okay, to water the garden. My interpretation is actually to envision Eden watering, all life coming from Eden is how I'm going to envision this. People will debate me on this one, but seeing how he's paralleling it out, he's actually trying to focus the source of this water, I think, to Eden. And then it's going to be divided and it becomes four rivers. This is not something unique to the Hebrew Bible. A lot of the other old accounts will talk about these four primordial rivers. Four is a number that normally symbolizes the totality of the world. Okay, like you have north, south, east, and west, like the four points of the globe. Definitely the Hebrew Bible will use four that way. There's always like four winds or these kinds of things. Four means like the totality of the earth with the created order. So there's one river that flows out of Eden and it branches into four. The Pishon, the Gihon, the Tigris, and the Euphrates. Now we know definitely where the Tigris and Euphrates are. Okay, that's ancient Babylon. The Fertile Crescent, Mesopotamia. The Pishon and the Gihon, like nobody knows where these rivers are. Okay, nobody really knows where these are. They're Hebrew names, and it's true. There's a spring that shows up at Jerusalem named the Gihon later on. But these two names in the countries of Cush and Havilah, people tend to actually make these both. Do I have that? Let's see. Yeah. So the Tigris and Euphrates are over here. Okay. And since they form a pair, a lot of people speculate that the other two are also a pair. And so you have the Nile and the Blue Nile that goes back into Ethiopia that's not on this map. So some people think they see the four rivers as those, the two of Egypt and the two of Babylon, which is interesting because those are two places that Israel will end up going into exile in, both those lands. But, you know, from late Jewish commentators, like Philo of Alexandria, and I was just reading actually Ambrose's account of this too. If I remember correctly, they said that the Gihon is the Nile, or the Pishon is the Ganges over in India. Okay, I don't know if the Hebrews knew about India over there, but what are we supposed to take from the symbolism of these things? It's not like all four of these rivers flow from the same source. Like, did the ancient authors think they all did? What it's trying to depict, if I wanted to get to the heart of it, is the fact that it's using the Tigris or Euphrates and most likely the Nile, and if you want to say the Ganges, I mean, that on its own is also like one of the largest rivers in the world. Rivers are where life flourished in the beginning. All civilizations formed around rivers. Egypt, I mean, in our art history class, we definitely saw this. Like, life flows from the rivers. Civilizations were born on the banks of rivers. As soon as man could do agriculture, the rivers were the lifeblood of their flourishing. So, the idea of that might be being portrayed here, and I think this is probably more closer to probably the spirit, if not like the direct letter of the image, is that all these sources of human civilization, of human progress, all flowed from the first grace of the garden. Okay? That's definitely how Ambrose will liken it. Ambrose will end up even taking a step further and say the four rivers will symbolize actually the four virtues, because it's by following these rivers back to their source through the virtues, one will then recover Eden again, because we all want paradise regained. Okay? That's not a territorial paradise, that's heaven. Now, Ambrose isn't just completely making something up. I do want you to write this cross-reference in the side of your Bible, okay, when it talks about those four rivers. Because, like, Sirach, the book of Sirach, well, talking about wisdom itself, okay, this is part of the Song of Wisdom. And look at, he uses this image. He goes, come to me, this is wisdom. Come to me, you who desire me, and eat your fill of my produce. For my teaching is sweeter than honey, and my inheritance sweeter than the honeycomb. And my remembrance lasts throughout all generations. Those who eat me will hunger for more. Those who drink me will thirst for more. Whoever obeys me will not be put to shame. And those who work with my help will not sin. All this is the book of the covenant of the Most High God, the law which Moses commanded us as an inheritance for the congregation of Jacob. It fills men with wisdom, like the Pishon, and like the Tigris at the time of the first fruits. It makes them full of understanding, like the Euphrates, like the Jordan at harvest time. It makes instruction shine forth like light, like the Gihon at the time of vintage. Just as the first man did not know her perfectly, the last one has not fathomed her. For her thoughts is more abundant than the seas, and her counsel deeper than the great abyss. So Sirach uses the image of these four rivers as symbols of actually wisdom itself that causes mankind to flourish. Yet the deep source of it you actually can't ever get to. You can always go deeper and deeper and deeper into wisdom. So Ambrose isn't like too far off the mark, maybe, at least according to later biblical texts. So Eden is the source of all the good benefits that we now have echoed in creation, where we find civilizations and stuff. Okay, so the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground. You want to box this too, because this is going to be a really, really important motif that I'll go into more detail later. But this idea that man is sculpted like a piece of, like a pot, like God forms a pot, okay? A clay jar. That's one of the reasons, hey, the earth had to get watered, it had to have moisture, and then you could shape the clay, if you will. Okay? But this is two form though. Lord God formed man of the dust, gave him a body, and then breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. We should pay attention. This is different than how Genesis chapter 1 portrayed God, because we're dealing with a personal God. God's personally forming man, and he's personally breathing into man. This idea that man has a spark, has a participation, actual life of God is present here, okay? Breathe into his nostril the breath of life, and the man became a living soul. Okay, where does man's soul come from? It comes directly from God. It does not come from the ground. This is a Hebrew concept right here. And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden, in the east. Box that one. That's going to be an important theme too. And there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground, the Lord God made to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life also, in the midst of the garden. And the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. These two trees. Everybody likes to harp about Gilgamesh. Because Gilgamesh, at the end of Gilgamesh, the guy goes to look for the tree of life so he can live forever. The Hebrew Bible is very familiar with the tree of life that is found in other cultures too, that other cultures talk about. What's unique to the Hebrew Bible is this whole one of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And this is actually going to be the important one in our Genesis account. The tree of life is actually almost like a secondary thing. The fall and punishment, like, it all revolves actually around this, the tree of knowledge of good and evil. But God made these two things too. Okay, then you have the four rivers. Then the Lord God took
man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, you may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you shall eat of it, you shall die. Okay? This is God continuing his works of distinction, like as he did in the last first chapter where he separates things. Well, he's made all these trees, and now he separates what man can eat and can't eat. There's a moral separation here. There's a divine command not to do something. Then the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him. So out of the ground, the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every bird of the air and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. Okay, to give somebody a name is to exercise dominion over them. Okay, hence why the Israelites don't ever actually say the divine name. Okay, they just say Adonai, Lord. Like to exercise a name over somebody, to give something a name is to exercise dominion over them. Okay, a name is a very magical thing, a very powerful thing. What this is showing you is that man is actually superior to all the animals because the animals themselves derive their names from man. Okay, this is an important idea. The man gave names to all the cattle, to the birds of the air, and to every beast of the field. But for the man, there was not found a helper fit for him. This is going to be an equivocation because God wants to make him a helper fit for him. We'll get into actually what that is. But there's another type of helper fit that's more fit for him too, which is important. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon man, and while he slept, took one of his ribs, closed up its place with flesh, and the rib which the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. Then the man said, this at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore a man leaves his father and his mother and clings to his wife, and they become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. Okay? Naked. The word for naked, well, to be naked is to have all your skin shown. Okay? And the word for skin is the same as light, okay? It's a homonym, at least, with the word light in Hebrew. Ephraim makes a big deal about this. They were naked, but they were clothed in light, okay? This idea of, like, the pristine, unfallen man has no shame because he does not know evil. This is man in his innocence. It says, she shall be called woman. Woman literally translates as, like, out of man, from man she's been taken. But that's not... This woman gets a name later on. Her name is Eve. But what's important is prior to the fall, she's not named by man. Man calls her something that's indicative of her nature. She's from the flesh. Her and man share the same flesh. Okay, they're the same species. But he doesn't give her a proper name because he doesn't have dominion over her. She is an equal helpmate. Another important thing, ladies... important for you to probably know, God formed man and then put man in the garden. Woman was made in the garden. Okay? So she actually had an excellence that man didn't have. Man was actually elevated into the garden, but woman started in an elevated state. Ambrose makes a huge allegory out of this too, about showing how the first, those with even greater gifts can also be the ones that fall, okay? Because woman is given a greater amount of grace in the fact that she's created only in the garden, whereas man is taken into the garden. Yet it's going to be woman that the first sin first comes through. So don't have pride. It's a check on pride in a lot of ways. Now, we should pay attention to a lot of these terms. We can see really quickly that this chapter 2 is really an agricultural kind of thing. Like, man as farmer is really important from the very beginning. Man as a gardener, if you will. Okay? Like, what's the problem? No man to till the ground. No man to actually shape the earth. Okay? God himself plants a garden. He acts like a gardener. And he makes every tree to grow, which are good for food. Okay, so these are trees that are actually... that man can use in order to make orchards and stuff, okay? Produce. A river flowed out of Eden to water the garden. Irrigation, okay, for the man who tills the ground. Man is put in the garden to till it and to keep it. This idea of man as manufacturer, of man as continuing and progressing the works of creation, of manipulating it, this is actually man's calling, is to exercise his dominion, not by sitting and hugging trees, but rather by exercising his intelligence onto creation, making it more fecund, more productive. Then the Lord God said, it is not good for man to be alone. Let's make a helper fit for him. Okay, so he formed every beast of the field. Box beasts of the field, because that's an important distinction. These are not wild beasts. These are actually domesticable beasts. Okay, they're the help fit for him. Man tills the ground by the help of lower animals, be they ox, be they oxes or even certain birds. Okay, help them out, you know, chickens. Goats are great for milk, these kinds of things. Okay, this is an obvious theme. This is a theme of the garden, not just a garden, but a gardener, and of man actually exercising work. Work is at the beginning. Work is not something that comes from the fall. That is what man's vocation is in a certain sense, to provide for God's creation too, while he provides for himself. Okay, what else do I go now here? So let's look at this. These are gifts, first gifts given to man. The Lord God formed man of dust. Okay, the body is a gift, it's a good thing. Breathe into his nostrils the breath of life. Okay, man has a soul, that's another good gift. And there he put man. Man is then put in the garden. That's an additional gift. These are all gifts that man has received from God freely. What else? Man's commission to till it and keep the garden. Okay, he exercises dominion over this garden. Man is giving every tree to eat of in the garden, except the tree of knowledge of good and evil. All the animals are brought to man, okay? They all belong to man, okay? And then woman is made and brought to the man. Woman is the ultimate gift, okay? That has been given to mankind, okay? There you go, women. There's another one. So look it. We ended up with seven. Seven original gifts in chapter 2. The seventh being the woman, okay? We can probably, if we wanted to read into it, we can definitely see well how this gets echoed in later on in the New Testament, where we say that Mary is the highest of all creation too. She's the greatest thing ever created, because Christ himself is God. Well, Genesis chapter 2, the woman is the greatest gift too, okay? That's been given to mankind. I think these are really important, so that we can see the tragedy of chapter 3. Now the serpent was more subtle than any other wild creature. Box wild creature, okay? That's a shift in terminology. That's not beast of the field. This is not an animal that is made to be domesticated with man. This is an animal that is outside of man's immediate orbit. The serpent. Now we should remember, this does not, and people will make a big deal about this, like as if chapter 3 is divorced from the rest of the Bible. But it's true. The serpent is never directly called Satan in the Old Testament. It's not. Like, this, what goes on here, it's explicitly called Satan. The serpent is explicitly called Satan in the last book of the Bible. Okay, Revelation 24:12. And the great dragon was thrown down, the ancient serpent, who is called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. He was thrown down to the earth and his angels were thrown down with him. That clear identification comes from John's book of Revelation. Hence why Christians have always interpreted the serpent as the devil. But you'll hear people try to say that the serpent's not, but it's clear that he is. John chapter 8 alludes to it. You are of your father the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and has nothing to do with the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks according to his own nature, for he is a liar and the father of lies. Okay, that's Christ himself speaking. Now, let us pay attention to how the serpent behaves. Let's see if Christ is talking about this serpent. Now, the serpent was more subtle than any wild creature, and the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say, 'You shall not eat of any tree of the garden?'" So pay attention. Is that a true statement? Did God say, "Don't eat of any tree"? No, good for you. That's right. God said, "Eat of all the trees except two." The devil lies immediately. The first thing out of the devil's mouth is a lie. Okay? He was a murderer from the beginning. It has nothing to do with the truth. Truly said. Okay? The word of God speaks the truth. So the devil's first words uttered is to misrepresent what God had said in the form of a question. And the woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it, lest you die.'" Now, did I put that right there is an addition. So we have a breakdown going on a little bit. Like, that is not what God said either. God didn't say don't touch it. He just said don't eat of it. So, but we also have to remember that the woman wasn't even there when God gave the prohibition. So that means the man has reinterpreted the rule. Maybe he made it even more pronounced a little bit. Like, okay, God said don't eat it. Don't even touch the thing, okay? Stay away from it. We should ask ourselves, why are they so close to it then? I mean, they're obviously going to be proximate to it because she just kind of just takes it. But anyway, so is he hedging the law? Is he making the law more restrictive? Or is this also showing you like maybe a breakdown of, you know, maybe we should just actually stick with what Christ says, my yoke is sweet and my burden light, you know? Maybe we're not supposed to overtax God's law. Maybe this is a breakdown a little bit. Instead of just saying what God said. Oh, it doesn't work. It doesn't work. But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not die." Okay, that's his second lie. The second thing out of his mouth is a lie. Okay? "For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." Okay? You will be like God, knowing good and evil. This is a half-truth that ever is a truth, okay? You will be like God? Well, it's true. God says they have become like me, but it's... we'll see, there's probably irony going on in that. But this is a third line. We'll always find threes for emphasis, okay? "You shall not eat of any tree. You will not die, and you will be like God." Eve's idea is, I will become a God. "So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate." Now we should, by paying attention to this, it tells you three different things. Okay, good for food, delight to the eyes, desired to make one wise. We should remember in verse 9, of the second previous chapter, all the trees that God made were pleasant to the sight and good for food. Okay? So our author here cites exactly the quality of every other tree. Okay? It's not tempting because it's good food. And it's not tempting because it's pleasurable to the eyes, because every single tree is like that. So what is the kicker that gets her? Make one wise. Okay? She wants knowledge, undue knowledge. She wants to know good and evil. And that should make you like, whoa, why do you want to know evil? Like, what's this? What's that going to do for you? "She took of its fruit and ate. And she gave some to her husband, and he ate." I don't know why. You're going to have to box this one, okay? Like, box this in red. Because the verbs here and stuff are going to find echoed throughout the book of Genesis. "She took of the fruit and ate, and she also gave some to her husband, and he ate." I don't know why they leave a phrase out that's in the Hebrew. It says, if I remember correctly, "She took of its fruit and ate, and she also gave some to her husband who is with her, and he ate." The "who is with her" is like missing from this translation. It's in the new RSV corrects this. But that's an important detail probably. They must not think it is, or they think it's redundant. But it brings actually to mind the idea like they're both actually at the tree. And so Adam's huge crime is to be silent the entire time. Like that's his big crime. Is he's the one that you can't just say, I didn't do it. Like you watch the whole thing playing out and you did nothing. To do nothing is just as guilty as to do it, okay? So that's a huge indictment on him. So anybody who wants to say that Adam was deceived by the woman is completely wrong. Adam's not deceived. He's witnessing the whole thing. That's his huge crime. To witness a crime and not say nothing. Huge. Big bad. That's what we call a sin of omission. Then the eyes of both were opened and they knew that they were naked. They knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. This is the reason why a lot of people think that the tree of knowledge of good and evil is a fig tree, okay? Because there's fig leaves that they use. Has anybody ever felt a fig leaf? Is it softy smooth? No, it's not, right? It feels like a cat's tongue, right? Okay, that's the worst kind of underwear you could ever make. Pay attention to that, okay? This is not like a good idea. Okay? They just got wisdom. But what knowledge did they get upon eating the fruit? Their knowledge that they got was their human frailty and their vulnerability. And now they're even feeling it. They're naked and they make these fig leaves to cover themselves. The coming of awareness of their own absence from God's law, of their failure, the knowledge that they gained is of their own failure. Okay? That's how they come to know evil, is because they experience actually performing it. We should actually, the trees are probably it's not a magical tree that gives you some kind of knowledge. Like, it was a test. And doing this thing caused the knowledge, but through experience of morality, okay? Creation was just meant it was all good. There was no evil in it. Now evil has entered creation because they themselves have done it. And what do? They disobeyed God. And they now have the self-conscious of their own defectibility, of their own ability of sinning, okay? Of their woundedness, of what sin causes, their nakedness, their vulnerability. Now, what happens next? And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of day. Okay? Now I could ask, now let's pay attention to this. So the devil gave three lies in order to get them to sin. Now you have God. They could hear him. They can anticipate the presence of God. Okay? And the man and the wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" Okay? This is theatrically playing out, actually, their moral state. Okay? They have lost their light. They have defected from God. They're hidden from God. And God calls to man, "Where are you? Where are you? You're not in my presence." I mean, does God know that they're hiding, wearing fruit of the looms in the bush? Of course God knows where they're at. What's he doing? And he said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden. I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself." He said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" So here we have three questions from God. Now I could ask one of my first communion students this, and they could figure it out because they've done it before. I didn't do this last year. I was like, why is God letting them hear him walk? Why does God ask them, "Where are you?" Like, does God know where they're at? Could God not make any noise? Like, yes, he can do everything. Like, where are you? Does God not know where they're at? No, he knows everything. "Who told you that you were naked?" Why is God asking a question? Doesn't he already know that? And they go, "Yeah, of course, he knows everything." I was like, why is God doing this for man? Because he wants man to admit it. He wants man to acknowledge the evil that he's done. In short, he wants man to confess. Whoa. Like, that's how reconciliation happens, right? You have to first own it. Instead of confessing, three triple opportunity to admit the truth on your own, okay, in opposition to the three lies against truth. Remember, the big test is actually the knowledge of good and evil, and it's all going to be just based on acknowledging the truth of who you are, who God is, and what you've done, and how you've disobeyed him. God wants man to admit the truth. Instead, what does man do? The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me the fruit of the tree and I ate." So the man immediately does not admit to the truth. Well, he gives a half-truth. Okay? The woman whom you gave. Okay? So he blames the woman and he blames God. Okay, you gave me the woman and she gave it to me. But you just stood there. Okay? That's, you're saying something true, but you're falsifying the fact that you're guilty. Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" Okay, so he's just, God's taking it in. He's like, "Okay, confess to me, woman, what have you done?" And the woman said, "The serpent beguiled me, and I ate." Well, the serpent lied to you, and you knew that he lied to you. Okay, and then you decided to believe his subsequent lies. You knew he was a liar from the beginning, and yet you decided to trust his testimony to mine. I said you would die. He said you would become like God. And you believed him, who you already identified as a liar. Sorry, you're not beguiled. He told you who he was before, at the first words out of his mouth. And you ate. So, they try to get out of it. Then the Lord God said to the serpent, where am I at now? "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all cattle and above all wild animals." So the two big groups of animals, those that can be domesticated and those that are in the wild, the serpent is cursed above all of them. "Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life." Okay? I'm convinced that there's a poetical thing going on here, because we have to remember man comes from the earth. Okay? He comes from the ground. That's going to really, like, come at the bottom of this section. And so the serpent who sought to consume or to break the relationship of a man with God, he's destined to constantly be on the soil, okay? And eat dust. Dust you shall eat. And that's probably like snakes lick the ground in front of them, okay? This is giving you an allegorical interpretation from something we see in nature. The snake goes around licking the dirt all the time. Well, he killed man by lying to him, okay? So that's the sin of the mouth, okay? And man is made from dirt. So the snake goes around on its belly, constantly reminding man of actually, he's trying to eat you, okay? By lying to you. That's what the curse of the snake on man. Then you have this, okay? This is really important. Proto-evangelium. This is known as like the very first promise of a Messiah, even by the Jews, okay? Definitely by the Christians. "I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." Okay? The Dewey readings will say, "She will bruise your head." The Hebrew is kind of ambiguous a little bit. Either way, it doesn't really matter if it's a he or a she, because if it's a Virgin Mary, she does so through the power of Christ, which is why very often images depicted of the woman crushing the snake is going to be Christ also stepping on top of her foot, which is on top of the snake's head. Our statue of the Blessed Virgin Mary in the side chapel, check it out next time you're in the side chapel. Mary is crushing the head of the snake, but then Christ is holding the staff, and the staff goes all the way down and hits the snake's head too. Okay, so they both crush. Okay, so your Bible's cool, okay, because it says she, but you guys' is cool too, because it says he. I don't want to let anybody tell you any different. Take them both. They're both cool. Okay? And then down at the bottom, "You are dust, the dust you shall return." I'm going to get into the curses here independently. I want to see something else first. What do I want to see? Oh, okay, this is what I want to see. Now, this is something that the Hebrew
formalism does, okay? We want to pay attention to our patterns. God first speaks here to Adam, okay? Who told you that you were naked, okay? Then God speaks to the woman. The serpent beguiled me and I ate it. And then the Lord God speaks to the serpent. That's C. So A, B, C. Because what happens over here is going to go in the opposite direction. Then God speaks to the woman and then to man, okay? So it goes man, woman, serpent, woman, man. Now, this is what we call a chiasm, which means it goes down and then it comes back out, okay? Why this is important? Because this is an artistic device to actually highlight the most important text. The most important text is going to be actually the center one, C, okay? Because C is framed by what he says to the woman and by what he said to man, okay? So C is of the most important. And this is where we find this pro-evangelium. Now, we should remember, when God said that if you ate, you would die, look at how long it's actually taken for man and woman to actually get cursed here. Instead, before anything bad happens directly by God punishing man and woman, they're already given this promise of actually the conquering of the snake, the curse of the snake, and the perpetual enmity and the eventual victory over the snake. This is actually what comes first out of God's mouth, before any curses unto woman and Adam. So let's look at these curses now. Do I have it? Oh, okay. Let me go through over here and go through the curses. Because you have done this, okay, I will put enmity, okay. To the woman he said, I will greatly multiply your pain in childbearing. In pain you shall bring forth children, yet your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you. Okay? So this is this aspect of mankind where men and women, I mean, women desire children so much that they will tolerate bad men. And that's been happening since the beginning, okay? And they still keep coming back together, okay? Because they desire. Now, I would also say this, he shall rule over you. People don't understand. Like, the reason why this is in this curse, I will multiply your pain and childbearing. In pain you shall bring forth children. Like, the fact is that these things are actually essentially linked. This bring forth children, desire for your husband is going to be really because of the children, okay? And he shall rule over you. Why? Because of the children. Like, a woman, because when she gives birth, she is 100% anchored to that infant. Because that infant will kill itself unless a woman is protecting it constantly, nursing it, providing for it. That kid can't move. It's going to take him like a good couple years before he's fully ambulatory. And even then, he can just get into danger all the time. Okay, that child needs to be governed constantly. For this reason, woman is anchored to child. For this reason, she becomes utterly dependent on somebody else providing nourishment for her so that she can provide for the child. Okay, now technology mutes this. Remember our last lecture, technology doesn't like change nature, it mutes the effects of nature. But if we didn't have supermarkets, if we were in an agrarian society, like the man would be gone all day long, okay? And the woman could not do anything because she has to take care of that kid all the time. And the man is like out slaving away in order to be able to bring home the meat, if you will, bring home the bacon all the time. So these things are all essentially linked. Like, she becomes utterly dependent on the man because of the child. Okay? And this prolonged adolescence that children have. And I think that's actually kind of like, I think this is all built into it. I've never read this before, so you can throw it away. But the childbearing pain, like, why is it? It is a unique thing for mankind. Like, mankind has a pretty traumatic birth experience. Do we have a traumatic birth experience? It's because our craniums are too large. So we have to come out early, okay? Have you ever seen a horse give birth? Like, the horse comes out in an hour, it's like jumping around. Like, it's like, and it's eating right next to its mom. But a child comes out and it's like this helpless creature with an oversized head. That's why it came out early. And like, it wants to still be in its mother, which is why, like, you know, the whole rocker thing works, or the swaddling clothes. Why? Because it wants to still be within the womb. So you mimic the womb in order to get a child to shut up. Like, because it wants to be inside its mom. It wants the gray noise. It wants to be moving as if mom's walking around. Like, it wants to still be in there for like another 9 months. It's like, why did it come out early? Why? Because its head was too big. It had to come out early because it would rupture the birth canal if it would wait for its full gestation period because of its oversized head. So a child comes out because its head needs to get out now. This is just nature, okay? I'm just saying. This is not biology class. But that's what increases the pain, okay? Which also kind of enslaves the woman to it more because the child is really, really, really helpless when it comes out. And I just find it almost like a really poetic justice since the sin was caused because she wanted knowledge, okay? And so what God does is a bit of irony. Okay, I'm going to give you a big head. You wanted a big head, I'm going to give you a big head. And then it's just repercussions. Bam, 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 bam. And we come out with big heads. Okay? There's some poeticism there. Think of that next time you see a baby. And say, you know what? Father's always right. He has a big head. But they proportion out pretty quickly, but they got big heads when they first come out. And to Adam he said, because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten of the tree of which I commanded you, you shall not eat of it. Okay, I commanded you not to, and you did anyway. You didn't listen to me, you listened to someone else. Now, well, and that's important because that tells you, like, we can actually cause each other to fall. We can't just blame everything on the devil. She was tempted by the devil. But Adam didn't listen to the devil directly. He listened to his wife, okay? Like, our morality, our immorality flows from many sources. Not only from the devil, but also from each other. This is an important lesson. Cursed is the ground because of you. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth to you. And you shall eat the plants of the field. In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread till you return to the ground. For out of it you were taken, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. So, man is going to die and he's going to turn back into dust. Snake's out there trying to eat dust all the time. As he's trying to eat man with his lies. Man, since he listened to his own flesh, well now his own flesh, I think we have to think of that way. Like, Adam means from earth, okay, or earth boy. And so, who's Adam's flesh was? Well, that was, he was formed from the earth, but Eve is his flesh. He listened to his flesh, and so in a certain sense then, his own flesh now rebels against him, because he came from the ground. So his ground, he has a misrelationship now with the ground from which he came, okay? Since he listened to what came from him, now that the thing that he came from doesn't listen to him anymore. Okay, this is the poetic justice that falls on Adam. Okay, and now he has to toil. He had to till before, but now he has to sweat. Now it causes pain. So there's pain. So she has pain and he has pain. There's a twofold pain. Moral vulnerability leads to physical vulnerability. That's the lesson of Genesis chapter 2 and 3. Then you have this. The man called his wife's name Eve. This is when Eve gets her name, okay? That happens after the curse. She gets her name Eve. Because she was the mother of all the living. Again, this is dark Hebrew comedy, okay? They're all doomed to die. It was told you that right now, okay? You are dust and dust you shall return. Okay, so it's after that they're all doomed to die that the woman gets the name Eve, which means she's the mother of all the living, doomed to die. Like, that's how you can interpret that, okay? Because the fact of the matter is that we're not all going to live. We're all going to die, whoever happens to live. So this is irony. I see it as irony, at least. And the Lord God made for Adam and his wife garments of skins. Oh, these are he names the cattle in 220. He doesn't name the woman in 223, but here Eve gets a name. I put the cross references there. In my Bible, I have lines drawn to those things. Then the Lord God made for Adam and his wife garments of skins and clothed them. That's another irony, because skins, that word right there is light, okay? Okay? And so you lost your light, okay? You saw that you were then naked and you were ashamed. Well, here's this other light. Now, on top of the irony, what this is too, you got to really pay attention and read between the lines. This is the first time a sacrifice is performed for the benefit of man. An animal is slain for its skin. Okay, and it's given to man. And not only is an animal, so this twofold thing, this will show up again in Genesis chapter 22. God himself intervenes, provides the sacrifice, and performs the sacrifice. Wow, that's an important thing. That happens right here before the expulsion from the garden. Okay, because it's going to be the same mechanism by which man can return to the garden. Garments of skins, that's a huge upgrade from the fig leaves. Okay, so we should see this also as a beneficial thing. Yeah, that's juxtapose that with 3:7. Fig leaves, bad. Skins, so nice, soft. I like that. That's a good one. Okay. Then the Lord God said, "Behold, the man has become like one of us, knowing good and evil." I believe this is irony here now, because God doesn't know what evil is directly through experience. But now man does. Man has become a moral agent like God, but God doesn't know evil, because God is not incapable of sin. He knows what evil is because he knows what not God is, or not what I command. But man himself is a moral agent with a free will, but he has chosen to experience evil by performing it. Okay, so in this way, man is like God in the fact that he's a moral agent and can choose to do good. I mean, God freely wills to do good. That's a true statement. But man chose instead to do evil. Lest he put forth his hand and take also the tree of life and eat and live forever. Okay, so God doesn't want him to live forever. And you might think, well, this is an additional curse, but this is actually probably a benefit. Because if man is in a fallen state, it's a bad idea to want to live forever. What? I want to live forever. And thorns and thistles and toil, sweat of my brow. That sounds like a great thing to do for all eternity. Okay? And greatly have pain in my childbirth and have domineering, you know, relationships. Like, that sounds like a great thing. Live forever. No, like, that's not a good thing at all. Therefore, the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from which he was taken. He drove out the man and the at the east of the Garden of Eden. Okay, so here we have this repetition. The Garden of Eden was put in the east. Now man is driven out from the east. We're going to constantly have this big eastward motion until we get to Abraham. So be sure to mark this east, east, east. He placed a cherubim and a flaming sword, which turned every way to guard the way to the tree of life. Later, Catholic tradition makes this cherubim Saint Michael, which is one of the reasons why, like, Michael is the angel that takes souls to paradise, to heaven, which is why, like in the Requiem Mass and the Offertory, you say, "May Saint Michael deliver them from obscurity and take them up to you with your blessed ones," because Michael guards the gate to paradise. So Eden becomes this paradise lost. It becomes the symbol of celestial paradise, of heaven. Okay, and what the Hebrew Bible teaches us is it cannot ever be accessed while on this earth. That's a new thing too, because other cultures like Gilgamesh finds the tree of life seeking to live forever. But this idea of man becoming like God and man finding eternity, man finding a fountain of youth, that is a foreign concept to the Hebrew Bible. What the Hebrew Bible wants you to know is you can never get it again. Gone. That is not the way you find paradise. That's why I don't think it's a big deal about trying to find out what the four rivers are. I think they obviously obfuscate the four rivers because the location of paradise is something that cannot ever be found or recovered. And it's perfectly guarded. Man can never get back in there. He can't live forever. Okay? Box this too. This is going to be an important concept. The cherubim had this flaming sword which turned every way to guard the way. It's the first time the way is used. Okay? And this way is going to course through like almost every page of the Bible, all the way through the New Testament. The way. The way to the tree of life. This is why we say man is a pilgrim. He has to be on the way. We're going to have to be revealed what this way is later on. Okay, sorry. Almost done. So, these are the six consequences of sin.
The eyes of both were open. They knew that they were naked. Okay? Man coming to experience and knowledge his own vulnerability, culpability, his bent morality of actually breaking, of committing a transgression. Man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. Second consequence, man is hidden from God, loses the presence of God. The curse upon the woman, summarized by the pain in the child bringing forth children, which also is like what the other ones all flow from. 3:17, the curse on the man. Curse is a ground because of you, all the consequences of the ground, of the disharmony between man's relationship with his original flesh, the dirt. 3:22, lest he put forth his hand and take also the tree of life and eat and live forever. The tree of life is prohibited for a man. And then the sixth thing, man loses the entire garden completely. Okay? So he loses the tree of life and he loses the entire. So he loses his innocence. He loses the presence of God. Pain. Loses the garden. Loses the tree of life and loses the garden total. Okay? Six. Six is the day on which man was made. There's six sins. You end up with this whole 666. Like, perfection of man is always going to be sixes. Now, there is a seventh here because it's the curse of the serpent. Could be number seven. Okay, so you can number it that way too. Six things for man and one for the serpent. So there's seven like changes, if you will, that take place through the fall. But again, the curse of the man, of the serpent, the seventh curse, this perfect curse, also carries actually the first assured victory in Genesis 3:15. Really important verse, that Proto-Evangelium. Okay. Any questions? Yes, ma'am.
In our class, I said that.
Whoa.
I asked if he was. In our class, I said that.
My art class or somebody else's?
Yours.
Oh, no.
I asked if he was made in, like, the dirt, but she was taken while.
He slept. What? She didn't come in the dirt.
I mean, in the darkness, at night.
Oh, at night. Oh, I see where you're coming from. I never even thought about that.
So when she created.
Because you were thinking of a different chapter. I was thinking of chapter 1. Because in chapter 1, they're made during the day. Right? But in chapter 2, he's sleeping. But it says God put him to sleep. I got to think about this longer. I don't think so. Because actually, pay attention to your time notes. Like, chapter 2 didn't tell you any time frame whatsoever. You don't even know how much time passed. How long were they in the garden? Who the heck knows? Like, this is going to be a salient thing of, like, the first, like, 10 chapters. Like time is this thing that the author doesn't really care about a lot of times. After chapter 1, gives you the sequence of six days. How long are those? Who knows? Because the sun and moon aren't made until day 4. But like chapter 2, it never tells you, except it says cool of the morning or cool of the evening or, when does it say that? Actually, you just made me think. Right after the fall, God's walking in the cool of the what? Cool of the day. Okay, what's cool of the day? It's like a noon or something. I don't know. What time is it? I don't know. It doesn't tell you. Radical imagination, you got to think. I would suspect that it's not at man's natural time of sleeping since God put him to sleep. You know? You have to put a child to sleep during the day, huh? But no one, everyone, well, I have to put myself to sleep at night because I stay up late. But good question, though. I like how you're thinking. Any other questions? No? Well, you know, there is a difference between curiosity and seeking knowledge, okay? But there is good knowledge to seek, too. So don't feel scared. Okay. Let's pray. In Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. Glory be to the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost. Amen. You're welcome. Thank you.
Yeah, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Our Lady, seat of wisdom. In the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Yes. Okay. So let's continue with the next chapter of Genesis. Title this one, we're going to try doing 4 and 5. I need somebody to give me a 5-minute warning of whenever I'm not actually supposed to get out of here. Okay. I'm going to try doing 4 and 5. Let's get right into it. I'm titling this The End of Paradise and the Beginnings of Civilization. I think probably we should juxtapose the life that man had in paradise. How long that was, we don't know. There was really no time note as far as how long they spent in there before they fell. One thing that we should, I didn't stress this as we went through everything, but now looking back, what we should do is actually really consider the various relationships that had been established in the first couple chapters that we've read so far. One is, like, in chapter 1, we got the relationship of God to creation. That's a clear relationship there. Like, God is the creator and everything else is from him. No other God created anything. So there's a clear relationship between God and creation as supreme being. On top of that, in chapter 1, it was established a relation between God and man, because man was made in God's image. Okay, so God has supreme dominion over everything. He himself makes everything. Then he makes man in his image and then gives man dominion over everything. Okay, so man functions as a sort of God in creation. But that's dependent on his relationship to being in the image of God. In chapter 2, we have subsequent relationships made. We see how man exercises dominion over creation by naming animals and these kinds of things. But also we have a new relationship established between man and woman. It's not just that these two are made in the image and likeness of God. It's also that they are fitting helpmates for each other. Now, I would maintain that they're supposed to be fitting helpmates in order to maintain the relationships already established, meaning their relationships with God and with creation. They're supposed to help each other maintain those relationships. What ends up happening, though, is that relationship gets broken between Adam and Eve because they transgress against God. We should actually think of St. Augustine's twofold commandment of love, which he's taken from Christ, which was this last Sunday's gospel, which is love the Lord thy God with thy whole mind and heart and soul, and then your neighbor as yourself. What happens in chapter 3 is that man wants to love each other more. They stress their own relationship first instead of God's first. They want to be like God's. And so they transgress the law that God imposed upon them. Don't eat of the tree. Because they disordered their relationship since they preferred their relationship to God's, well, consequences happen. Okay, first they have to love their own relationship to God, then to each other. That's actually how it's going to be properly ordered. It gets disordered what they want. Another thing I didn't stress is the test happened around this tree of knowledge. And it's good and evil. What I did stress is because what everybody primarily focuses on is the shame that's felt, the nakedness that's realized, the vulnerability that is experienced, the awareness that one has now become hidden to God because one has broken the relationship with God. But it's not just the knowledge of evil. I mean, they know evil because they've experienced it, but it's also the knowledge of good and evil. I think we should actually understand acquiring knowledge of actually how good everything is amplifies one's transgression when one breaks it. And so they did become very aware of how wrong they were because actually when they took of the fruit, they became more intensely aware of how good God is and how what he created was, the order of it, how good that was. And so their disorder actually makes it so much more appalling Okay, so they become more sensitive to the evil because actually they become more intimately aware of the good. We should actually always remember that, like, evil is always a privation of a good. The more intensely you know good, conversely, the more intensely you experience evil. This is why even saints, like, become so aware of how wrong even venial sin is, because they're so intimately aware of what is good. So the tree is a knowledge of good and evil. Very often people don't stress that goodness that they came to experience. Well, this breaks a relationship, and all of a sudden we have a repercussion of broken relationships. Man's relationship with between each other, man and woman, gets kind of colored with conflict, be it the increased pains of childbirth. Okay, that's a woman with her progeny, and we can actually. We can actually even amplify. I think the next chapter is going to be how much sorrow a woman can have from her children. But also that of the dominion of man over woman, the friction that happens between the two fitting helpmates. And then also man's relationship with creation, also friction enters into it. Thorns and thistles, sweat and toil. These kinds of things. Ultimately now, man's relationship is one that is going to be characterized with striving. There's actual energy has to be exerted in order to maintain the relationship between man and the garden, between man and the soil, and also between woman and husband. Okay? It's not something that's just going to be magically harmonious. That is not the relationship that man now enjoys. That was a relationship within the garden. As long as you maintained your twofold love, love God first and then each other. But since they twisted that, everything else experiences the disorder through all their relationships. Then I guess lastly, the last relationship that we could probably throw into this is man's relationship to the garden, to paradise, to Eden, which has been definitively shut off, guarded. And so now they have to experience the world outside of paradise. And that way is guarded by an angel. Meaning, they've been banished, it's hidden, it cannot be regained. Now we have to remember, chapter 2 gives us a very physical paradise. This is not going to be, this functions as a symbol, as a type in Christianity, for a very real spiritual paradise to be had now, which if we do that, if we achieve that spiritual paradise now of baptismal innocence, of healed relationship with God and the creature and man, and love of neighbor, charity, then we will attain the concrete physical paradise in the hereafter. As the book of the Apocalypse says, the new heaven, new earth. So, as far as a physical heaven, that relationship is definitively broken. And we shouldn't be looking for that physical heaven as in this temporal existence we have. So, they've been banished. And immediately, we have the establishment of now a new relationship. Eve and her children. Now, Adam knew Eve, his wife. And she conceived and bore Cain, saying, I have gotten a man with the help of the Lord. And again she bore his brother Abel. Now Abel was a keeper of sheep, and Cain a tiller of the ground. This phrase here, Adam knew his wife Eve, this knew, having knowledge of his wife, this is a euphemism for relations between the man and the woman. It is probably linked a little bit to their coming of knowledge because they become aware of their nakedness. That's true. That's built into that. But this, he had knowledge of her in the garden when he fell in this way, as far as what is going to happen. But now he exercises that and they start to fulfill actually the commandment of God to be fruitful and multiply. That was given in chapter 1. So this is actually interesting. If you were to read chapter 3 or chapter 2
without any knowledge, and this is so hard for us to do because we already know how the story goes. But if you were to read chapter 2 without any knowledge of what comes before, when God says, don't eat of the tree lest you die the death, like you would think as upon eating it, they will die. It's like a poisonous apple. That's how somebody would probably read this story. Instead, they eat it. They don't die. There's no death. And then they get banished. You're like, oh, now do they die? And then what do you have first thing is you have life. You have a continuation of the story. Okay? There's life coming. So where's the death? Where's the death? I thought that once you eat of the tree, you die. Well, this death is delayed. Instead, we see actually God continually to govern his creation. And Eve and Adam fulfilling the first commandment they were given, be fruitful and multiply. So I guess we could probably read in they're possibly trying to live, reestablish a relationship with God. Two sons. This is a really important concept. These two children of Eve. Does she have other ones? I don't know. I really don't. Is this supposed to be an exclusive list? Well, they can't be because we have to maintain that all humanity comes from the same stock. That's a doctrine of the faith. Which means this first generation post-Adam, like they had to marry sisters. They had to marry sisters. And then the subsequent generation, they can do first cousins, which frankly still happens in the Amazon. So at least for that first generation, out of sheer necessity for the propagation of the species, there have to be sisters involved. But Genesis isn't going to actually focus on the women. When the women do show up, we should pay attention because typically it's going to be real male-dominated. So Cain and Abel. Again, it doesn't really give you... Well, let me get into the names. Cain means possession, acquisition, fabrication. Okay? This is a play on actually what she says. I have gotten a man with the help of the Lord. Gotten. Kaniti. Okay? It sounds kind of like the name Cain. Now, Abel, they just give you the name. It doesn't say one way or the other. I think that's interesting, though. Eve seems to name Cain. She's exerting some sort of dominance on him, I guess, maybe, possibly. I don't know. Abel, we don't know how he gets his name. But Abel means a breath, vanity, vapor, a fading away. It is a word that will come to mean poetically like the transitory of life. I have a quote here from Ecclesiastes 1:2. That's the famous vanity of vanity, says the preacher. Vanity of vanities, all is vanity. That word vanity there is Abel, Abel. Everything's going away. Everything's going away. The fact that Abel's name means a vapor that fades away is a foreshadowing of how quickly he's going to leave our story. Abel was a keeper of sheep, Cain a tiller of the ground. How much time has passed by? Our story really doesn't want to give like actual historical chronology per se. It really wants to just get to the pith of actually this story of two brothers. Keeper of sheep, tiller of ground. We've seen these concepts alluded to, okay? Cain being a tiller of ground. In chapter 2, God took the man, put him in the Garden of Eden to till it. Okay, and to keep it. So Cain is functioning exactly how his father is. Now, part of the curses that Adam experienced was, curses the ground because of you, and toil shall you eat of it all the days of your life. Okay, so the cursed ground, the working of the ground, the difficult labor, like Cain is following these footsteps of his father. I'm not saying there's a negative note on this, okay, because God made man to till the garden. Well, now man is striving to till the earth outside the garden. This is what Cain does. Abel is a keeper of sheep. This is kind of sort of a new concept. This goes back to chapter 1, where God tells man to have dominion over the fish and over the birds and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. Okay, like practice husbandry on these things. These creatures exist for you. Well, here Abel has become a keeper of sheep. Another vague reference to the fact that they're using domesticable animals is the fact that right before their expulsion, the Lord God made for Adam and for his wife garments of skins and clothed them. Okay, there was some sort of animal sacrifice that God performed, at least as far as killing something for something else. And he clothed them with skins. Okay, so the use of animals for man, the first time we get it is actually with God making clothes for man, new light, if you will, and now we have Abel as this keeper of sheep. These two classifications of men are going to constantly be, we're going to find them always in conflict, tillers of ground and then the pastoral people, people who move and people who build cities, because you can't till the ground unless you're by a river, unless you have consistent irrigation. So they tend to be static people, whereas the shepherds tend to be moving around a lot. These two types of people are in these two types of brothers. In the course of time, how much time? I don't know how much time. But now they must be old, okay, because they're all offering their own sacrifice and stuff. In the course of time, Cain brought to the Lord an offering of fruit of the ground. Abel brought some of the firstlings of his flock and of their fat portions. And the Lord had regard for Abel and his offering. But for Cain and his offering, he had no regard. So Cain was very angry. His countenance fell. The Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why has your countenance fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin is lurking at the door. Its desire is for you, but you must master it." I want you to pay attention to actually how these names are arranged. This is something even Ambrose like picks up on. He goes, hey, Cain's born first, and then it's Abel. But then the author tells us that he gives us Abel's profession first, and then Cain's secondly. Okay, Ambrose allegorizes this into how like the last shall become first. Okay, but we do see this in the arrangement, how the biblical author is actually packaging the names. He's not just giving you a repeated sequence. He wants Abel to be in the middle, okay, in this first paragraph. In the second paragraph, we notice it's actually the same thing, okay? The same kind of sequence is put up. So we should know that, like, Abel is special because he's, like, packaged in between Cain. He has this double thing in the middle. But this is how we can actually schematize this. These A, B, B, A, B, B, A. These are tools, literary tools, that the author would use in order to actually show you where to look, to pay attention to things. Okay, so Abel is going to be the preferred. He's special. There's something special about Abel in consequence of keeping sheep, of Abel's types of sacrifices, okay, and the fact that the Lord has regard for Abel. Cain frames Abel. The climax is Abel. Okay, so why does God have favor on Cain's sacrifice? Well, before I actually get that, maybe I should just say, why are they sacrificing? This is a new concept too. In a certain sense, God never commanded sacrifices. Okay, we have a couple commands. Have dominion, be fruitful, multiply. But this is something that we find in the natural law. Like every culture across the entire world offered sacrifice in some form or way or shape. This is a natural law. Sacrifice is actually how we, if we remember from our religion class, sacrifice is an act of religion, which means it's an act which reaffirms our subjection as to a creator. We are a creature and we are dependent on a creator. Sacrifice isn't In this biblical context story, it doesn't actually tell you like he's trying to feed God or he's trying to do anything like this. They're just doing this as a matter of course. Like we perform sacrifice. Another thing that is really popular now is actually thinking of sacrifice. This is a very pragmatic way of looking at sacrifice, but of learning this lesson that it's a fact of life, which is that you have to, in order to have a successful future, man must learn to delay their satisfaction of things. Man must actually get rid of things in the present
in order to get things in the future. Like, you are sacrificing your liberty right now in order to have an education for the future. Because you're hoping that, like, will work out for you later on. I promise you it will, unless you don't pay attention. Then you're just wasting your time. It's not a really good sacrifice. Okay? You could be doing something much better with your time. But man must learn to have delayed satisfaction. Like, this is something very... Like, kids don't do this naturally. Right? Kids, like, I want it now. Like, Veruca Salt and, like, Willy Wonka's Chocolate Factory. Like, that's how kids are, and it's abominable. Like, a kid who's like that, if they don't shake out of that, if it must always be their way in the immediate now, like, no one's going to want to hang out with them. They won't get very far in life. Okay? Life, part of life, part of the toil, if you want to put it that way, or the sweat of the brow, part of the difficulty of life is we have to sacrifice things in the present in order to have better things in the future. One of the ways that we learn this lesson, practically speaking, is by performing sacrifices. Literally, I'm going to get rid of this thing because it'll be better for me in the future if I do. Well, ultimately, we acknowledge God as our creator, and so we perform sacrifices on his behalf, not because he needs them, but because we need to constantly be reminded of how much we're dependent on him. Again, Christianity, the nature of the sacrifice and the it's good for me, delayed satisfaction now for a future thing. The future thing is beyond the grave, okay? It's not like I'm going to sacrifice this now because I'm going to get like really rich if I do so because God's going to shower me with lots of like money. Like, that's never been a concept of Christianity. The prosperity gospel, if you will. But anyway, these two brothers are offering sacrifice. Cain offers it from the fruit of the ground, okay? An offering of the fruit of the ground. Abel brought some of the firstlings of his flock and of their fat portions. This little subtle additional details here might give us an indication of why Abel's is preferred over Cain's, okay? So, if our author wanted to be perfectly symmetrical, he would have just said, Cain brought to the Lord an offering of fruit of the ground. Abel brought an offering from his flock. Like, that would be equivalent. But instead, what happens? He gives us a couple additional information. Firstlings of his flock. The first things that show up from his flock. The first new sheep that are born that season. You know, if the females don't give birth after you sacrifice those ones, like, you're going to be in trouble because you won't have anything, like... Nope. So that's a big gamble, if you will. Firstlings. Those are the prized ones, the first ones. And some of their fat portions. Now we get this later on in the book of Leviticus, like this distinction of the different parts of the animals and the ones that are being used properly for sacrifices. The fat portion are the best portions. So we do have maybe a possible indication that the spirit of Abel's sacrifice is one of offering to God his best. Whereas Cain is just offering him his typical. Maybe that's why God has regard for Abel, and not Cain. Maybe it's completely arbitrary, and that's probably important for us all to actually know too. Like, sometimes God can have... That's what St. Thomas calls the principle of predilection. Like, God can love whoever he wants, however much he wants. Like, it doesn't have to be... We can't force his hand. He can just decide to favor this one, not this one. And if he chooses to do that, that doesn't mean that there's not a good future for either one of those cases. That just has to deal with how God is choosing to go forward and how he wants salvation history to play out. Very often people get gifts that we don't have. Why? Did they deserve it? No. That's why it's called a grace, a gift freely given. Did the Blessed Virgin Mary merit to be the Mother of God? Like, she was conceived immaculate. Like, okay. Why? Why did God have favor on her? It's not fair. Why isn't that fair? You can't, like, charge God for injustice for just giving good things. Okay, so he had a good thing on Abel. If you understand the relationship of creator and creature, you should be perfectly fine with that. Instead, Cain isn't. Cain gets angry, his countenance fell. Now, this verse 7 is probably, like, later Hebrew, like, transcribers wouldn't even, like, they would call it an indeterminate verse because it's extremely complicated. Like, nobody actually knows how to translate it because it's so elliptical. It has so many words missing from it that it's kind of guesswork of what this is. This, why are you angry? Why is your countenance fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin is lurking at the door. Its desire is for you, but you must master it. The general sense that most people can see is this idea that Cain is upset and he's looking down. There's like a downward kind of poetry to it. His countenance is fallen, okay? If you do well, will you not be accepted? If you are upright, okay? If you do good, things will be good for you, okay? It's not dependent on what just previously happened. It's how you respond to the situation, okay? So you had this downward face. Hey, will you not be accepted? You have this like upward rising and you'll be looking up. Hey, you'll be upright, okay? If you do not do well, sin is lurking at the door. Its desire is for you, but you must master it. Okay, this idea that now, well, sin was lurking at the door in the garden too. This idea, though, that we always have to be on guard of our ability of defecting, of failing. Sin is lurking. The word "lurking" there, actually, it's a verb that's normally used on for lions later on. So. The devil's always going to be portrayed as a lion, or an adversarial force is going to be a lion. So this sin is lurking, okay? It's couching at the door of your tent. Its desire is for you, but you must master it. That's a good idea. Like, we can actually master it. Like, we don't have to be a victim of it. That's not how our story goes, though. Cain said to Abel, his brother, how much longer is this? I don't know how long this is. Obviously, he doesn't master it, though. Let us go out to the field. And when they were in the field, Cain rose up against his brother Abel. Rose up, okay, if he was upright, okay, if he did well, he would become upright. But now he's uprising himself in order to commit evil, okay. Rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, where is Abel, your brother? This is our second sin in the book of Genesis. Cain rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. How did he kill him? You know, what did he kill him with? Our story doesn't tell us. You'll see artistic depictions. Some of the like medieval manuscripts will... Normally it's an instrument of Cain's profession. Since he's a tiller of soil, it'll be like a plow or something like this. But metal objects aren't made yet, so it's not like a hoe or that you would think of, okay? In this painting, he's holding a jawbone, okay? And primitive, at the beginnings before the invention of metallurgy, they would use bones for these kinds of things. So a jawbone might be a primitive type of plowhead. Often he's depicted with a rock. He rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. So here we see again, though. There's a broken relationship with God, and that then turns into a broken relationship between man and man, between brothers. But one follows the other. It's very important. The first three commandments, an infraction against those leads to an infraction against the bottom seven. Twofold command of love. Where is Abel, your brother? We kind of see sort of this sort of repetition. It really wants to get you into, hey, we've been through this story before. They ate of the tree, and then you had Adam, where are you? And now we have Cain kills Abel, and then you have God asking, where is Abel, your brother? He said, I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper? Don't ever say that when your parents ask you where your brother is. So many people use that quote not realizing they're quoting Cain, okay? Like, you don't want to quote Cain. Like, that's indefensible, okay? Because the point is you are your brother's keeper. And the Lord said, what have you done? Again, a second question. Now,
There's not a third question of the Lord's here, but Cain actually gives us the third question. So there is a sort of a parallelism with the three questions to Adam. Where are you? What have you done? Who told you you were naked? Well, here Cain adds the second question. I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper? He lies, first of all. Okay, in the form of a question. The voice of your brother's blood is crying to me from the ground. And now you are cursed, so now we just get an immediate punishment, okay? Cain never fessed up to his truth. God always knew what it was. Cain didn't confess. Here's the punishment. Cursed from the ground, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you till the ground, it shall no longer yield to you its strength. You shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth. Cain said to the Lord, my punishment is greater than I can bear. Behold, you have driven me this day away from the ground, and from your face I shall be hidden, and I shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth. Whoever finds me will slay me. Then the Lord said to him, not so. If anyone slays Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold. And the Lord put a mark on Cain, lest any who come upon him should kill him. Then Cain went away from the presence of the Lord and dwelt in the land of Nod, east of Eden. So here's our parallel that this is making, actually, from Genesis chapter 3, okay? Yes? 5 minutes already? Oh, man. Okay. Because you have listened to the voice of your wife, okay? When Cain gets his punishments because he listened to the voice of his wife. In this case, the voice of the brother of Cain is actually God's listening to his voice. Okay, this is going to have different repercussions. Cain gets cursed from the ground. Adam was cursed. The ground becomes cursed because of Adam. Now, they're both tillers, okay? So Adam, the ground was cursed, so he had to plant stuff. It would be difficult. Well, his son, who follows in his profession, doesn't plant vegetables. What's he do? He plants the blood of his brother. Okay? He curses the ground even more. Because according to his profession, he basically pours his brother's blood into where he's supposed to be developing bread. Uh-huh. His own strength. So for Cain, it shall no longer yield you its strength. For Adam, so this is an intensification. For Adam, it's with toil that he will get strength from the ground. For Cain, it now no longer will even generate food for you. Okay, so now he's lost his ability of being fixated in a place. Okay? Yeah.
Is that why Cain's sacrifice wasn't as...
Oh, because the ground's cursed?
Yeah.
I don't want to go there, but that's a good way of thinking about it. People have thought about it that way. Mm-hmm. People have thought about it that way. So you're justified in saying that. Does anybody understand what she said? Since the ground was cursed with Adam, then the sacrifices aren't good. Except there are cereal offerings later on in the Old Testament. So... But you're not the first person to say that, so good for you. Yeah.
But then were those other sacrifices after Noah's flood? After
that's true too. So good for you. It doesn't really tell us why. So I would pour as much meaning into it as you want. It's not looked on because God could be completely arbitrary. That's valid. It's not looked on because the ground's cursed, okay? And so it's only through sweat and stuff that we don't want to offer God our. We want to offer God the good things of the earth, not necessarily the sweat of the earth, okay? Or myself, huh? Because man, fallen man is doomed to die and turn into dirt, okay? And dirt's what the snake eats and all that stuff. Possibly. Or the intention of the sacrifice because of the firstlings and the fat, okay? Those are all three valid things, I think. This is an important word, okay? Cain's punishment. He's a wanderer on earth. This is supposed to be linked to this idea like the path, the way to the garden is now closed. Like people can't find a way back. Well, they're not really moving away from that closed door. They're kind of proximate to paradise probably. Well, this idea
of Cain being a wanderer. He's pathless, okay? He doesn't know his way back now. Now, this is a consequence of the fact that he can't actually farm for food. He has to constantly be moving around to acquire new food. He's like a hunter-gatherer, if you will. But he's an allegory of actually somebody who's lost their way, to be a wanderer, okay? And this is repeated a second time, this wander on earth. And then Cain went away from the presence of the Lord and dwelt in the land of Nod, okay? Nod in Hebrew means wanderer, okay? So he's a wanderer who goes to the land of wandering. This is, he's a personification of somebody who has lost their way of how to live with God and with one's neighbor. Just like in the Genesis story where you actually had a blessing put, God made animal clothes before he exiled them. Well, here Cain gets a mark. So we always have mercy actually built into the stories when God does the punishment, if you will. And East of Eden, likewise, another repeat of what we already said. So I'm just going to throw these up here. These are our parallels. These are clear parallels. It really wants us. They knew that they were naked. Adam knew his wife. Okay, the curse on the woman is the desire for her husband, and he shall rule over you. God's advice to Cain is that sin desires you, but you must master it. Okay, you listen to the voice of your wife, the voice of your brother. You see the repeating terms. Okay, the cursed ground, the cursed ground. He drove out the man. Behold, you have driven me this day away from the ground. East of the Garden of Eden, to the land of Nod, east of Eden. This is a clear parallelism between chapter 3 and 4. So this is our way our author, by structuring his story, really wants us to see, actually, there is still an order going on in man's disorder. Okay? And also, as it was for the parents, so it is for the children. Okay? And by consequence, I think we could probably keep expanding this concentric circle through all of men, all of time. Okay? These things are always operative for us. These different concepts. Also, I would like to say, do I want to say that? No, I don't want to say that. I forgot already. I'm done, right? Am I done? Okay. Good. We'll finish there. I'll say that what I wanted to say later. May your Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. Glory be to the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Benedictio Dei Nutentis, in a patris et filii spiritus sanctis, et super vos, et mani semper. Amen.